So you're not going to make fun of anybody, are you? No, call us all out. That's good. Okay, so another good thing is that Garden Sanctuary, we thank them so much for hosting this for us this evening, but they have provided some pretty good hors d'oeuvres for us. They've got a charcuterie board and some other snacks, coffee and that kind of thing in the fellowship hall. So that is right up the breezeway into their gym area. And so they have that for us as well. So that's going to happen about 6:45. So you'll have a chance to get up and move around and get some things to eat. So without any further instructions, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Mark Newman.
By the way, Melissa sent out to you, I see some of you have outlines. Do any of you not have outlines, and do we have any outlines to give them if they don't? Yes, we do. If you don't have outlines, would you raise your hand? This is a class, so we're going to be taking notes. Raise your hand, they're going to bring you an outline. Everybody else has an outline. Outstanding. Yeah, and just come on in and just sit as close to the front as you dare. As you can imagine, a lot of things have changed in the last 48 hours. 48 hours ago, I was standing in Hopkinsville, Kentucky, and I was keynoting a banquet like I'm going to be doing here tomorrow night for an area pregnancy center when the news broke. I just stepped off the platform. A guy walked up to me with a smartphone. I looked at the headline, and even though I had anticipated, based on how I examined the oral arguments in the Dobbs case, that they were, in fact, going to overturn Roe versus Wade, it's kind of like when you know someone and you've known them for a long time, they've been ill for a long time, and you can foresee the fact that they're going to die eventually, but the day when it actually happens, it's kind of a shock to your system. Well, when I saw that ruling come down, and of course, I want to clarify, the ruling has not come down. All we have is a draft. The draft is from February. If you know anything at all about how the Supreme Court operates, those people can flip their vote anytime they want to, all the way up until that decision gets published, which means we're not out of the woods yet, not by a long shot. And by the way, even if it comes down exactly the way it's written, as you're going to find out this evening, we aren't remotely out of the woods even then. Okay? So we got to be really careful not to be spiking the football too early. Okay? But I will tell you, I have been working toward this for over 30 years of my life. So to see it actually happen, or at least appear like it's going to happen, was pretty amazing and emotional. And as you will find by the time this evening is over, I'm not somebody who is, it's hard to get me to cry in public. I think that two nights ago was the first time it had happened in my entire life. So it was pretty amazing. Many of you have no idea in the world who I am, why you're sitting down there, and why I am standing up here. So I want to give you a little bit of background on myself. In 1987, I was the director of speech and debate at the University of California at Irvine. I have been a university professor for most of my career, even though during the time I was a university professor, I also happened to be working closely with pregnancy counseling center groups and National Right to Life affiliates. I came to this in a very weird way. Have you ever had people say, well, the reason you're pro-life is because you're a Christian and all you Christian people are pro-life? I am not a pro-lifer because I'm a Christian, not even remotely. As a matter of fact, I don't know that I actually ever heard a sermon on abortion growing up. I'm starting to wonder if, in fact, maybe the first time I ever heard a sermon on abortion was when I actually preached. Okay, so it took me a long time. How did I come to the conclusions that I'm going to share with you this evening? When I was the director of speech and debate at the University of California at Irvine, one of the associate pastors at my church, a man by the name of Arthur Ellison, you always have to learn how to wait for that stuff, a man by the name of Arthur Ellison decided to take a one-year leave of absence and become a director of this weird thing called a crisis pregnancy center. That's what they called them back in the day. He knew that I was doing corporate training work while I was teaching and coaching up at UC Irvine, so he said, hey, would you come down and would you train my staff? And I said, sure. What do you do? Oh, I'm running this new crisis pregnancy center. I said, that's awesome. What's that? Oh, well, you know, we provide women with an alternative to abortion. And I didn't know anything about this issue. But pretty good researcher, so I said, tell you what, send me a couple of books, a couple of seed articles, and I will take the material that I use for corporate folk, and I will retrofit it for your people. And so I did, and he sent me, the least of these by Kurt Young, he sent me a book by Bernard Nathanson, who was one of the country's most notorious abortionists, who then flipped over and became a pro-life advocate, and a couple of other articles. And I will tell you, by the time I finished reading these books and looking at these articles, I was floored. I could not remotely believe that what I was reading about was legal in the United States and actually had a large group of people championing it out in the public square. So I went down, I trained these people, and I thought, okay, that's kind of it. By the way, never tell God you're going to do him a favor. Okay, don't ever do that. That's a really bad idea. So what I thought was, well, you know, I did one of these. I don't mind. I'll come out maybe once or twice a year. I'll work with these, you know, little Christian nonprofits. Because, see, in my mind, I was going to be training in the big glass buildings, you know, in Irvine. Within probably 3 years, 95% of all the consulting work I did was with pregnancy resource centers and National Right to Life affiliate groups all over the United States. And I have been doing this ever since. I did not come to my knowledge regarding the life issue because I heard it from the pulpit. And by the way, I say that to the shame of the church because I should have heard it from the pulpit. I came to my understanding about the pro-life issue on the basis of cold, hard evidence, which is how I've always taught all of my students to come to conclusions about anything. If you can't defend it, you probably ought not believe it. And so what we're going to be doing this evening is we are going to be learning about how to make the case for life. Now, like I said earlier, right, we've got this draft opinion that is leaked out. We don't know if that's actually what it's going to look like. We don't know if somebody might flip and choose something else. We have no idea. But I'm going to tell you right now, even if that draft goes through exactly the way it's out right now, there should be 12 times this number of people in this room. Because your opponents are organized, and they have a battle plan to make sure that even though here in South Carolina it looks like you guys would probably ban most, if not all, abortions, only for right now. See, it's going to be legislative. And that means the minute that they overtake your legislature, they're going to change your laws. And if you don't think that, and by the way, they've already got a plan for how to do it. We'll talk about this book a little bit more later. But this is a book called Handbook for a Post-Roe America by Robin Marty. It's in its second edition. This is the first one. Please do not buy this book. I don't want to give Robin Marty a dime. But you can find it in a used bookstore. Get a hold of it and read it. When your opponents want to actually hand you their battle plan, it's a really good idea to become familiar with it because we're in a war. So when the war is over, the literal physical lives of unborn children. You want to get to know this. We have opponents. They have plans. The unborn, unfortunately, even though they are the chief casualty, but not the only casualty, in this battle, have no voice except you. And I mean you, the people physically in this room, because the research that I have done, as I'm about to show you, demonstrate that Christians in particular and our culture at large is so woefully ignorant about the abortion issue and about fetal development and about the sanctity of human life and how to be able to make a scientific or even moral case out in the public square. It is appalling. So tonight, not only are you going to learn how to do that, but I am going to deputize you. This is not an evening of entertainment, ladies and gentlemen. This is an evening of equipping. You're going to learn how to do something, and once you've learned how to do it, it is an obligation you will have to share that with other people, and I will show you how to do that. So this evening, what we're going to do is we're going to learn how to make the case for life by looking at the scientific, at the moral, and at the biblical evidence. By the way, the biblical evidence is great when we talk in the church, but you can make a completely compelling case for life using nothing more than science and moral reasoning, which is acceptable at any high school, college, or university in America. Right? We all argue that way. But because we also need this to happen in the church, I'll provide you with the biblical case for life as well. Then we're going to talk about the risk every single one of us in this room face from abortion ideology, which, by the way, if Roe v. Wade is overturned, that ideology is not going away. As a matter of fact, it has its home in virtually every high school, college, and university in America. And if you think that when we overturn Roe, they're all just going to go, oh, wow, had no idea. I guess we'll change what we teach our students. Right? You don't have a clue. So we have a very large battle ahead of us. Then finally, we're going to talk about what each and every one of us sitting in this room today can do. One brief note. I only have 3 hours. That's all I have. Can we all agree I could not read this book to you in 3 hours? Right? It wouldn't actually be physically possible for me to do it. What book is this? This is a book called A Defense of Abortion by David Boonen. This is the most cutting-edge philosophical book on making the argument that abortion is morally permissible. Now, I don't want you to get all afraid and stuff because this looks like a big, thick book. And I will let you know, reading it is tough sledding if you don't do college-level or graduate-level reading. But let me encourage you a little bit. See how thick this book is? This is the response to this. You'll notice it's a lot shorter. It's by Christopher Kaiser. It's called The Ethics of Abortion. It's got interesting, when people publish books. Well, for example, my book. I've got blurbs on it from other people telling everybody how great my book is. Well, listen to this blurb. This is one of the very best book-length defenses of the claim that abortion is morally impermissible. In other words, you shouldn't be able to do it. It is clear, thorough, thoughtful, and carefully argued. I would strongly encourage anyone who's interested in the subject to read it and to study it. Who wrote that blurb? David Boonen. On the back of Christopher Kaiser's book. They're actually intellectual friends, and I think that Chris is moving David. Why am I showing you this? You will never encounter in casual conversation or on the vast majority of U.S. college or university campuses, you will never encounter the sophistication of argument that you find in this book, because most people have no clue. What you're going to find when you talk about abortion, and I'm sure all of you will just nod your head when I say this to you, what you normally encounter is what I will call bumper sticker arguments, right? My body, what's the next part of that? My choice. That's not an argument, folks. It's a bumper sticker, okay? Because you got to prove a lot of things to make that claim true, and they can't prove any of them. But they'll say it a lot. Matter of fact, I heard them chanting it over the last couple of days. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at the most common arguments that you will normally encounter. Now, what happens if, for some weird reason, at Starbucks next week, you happen to sit down, somebody realizes, oh, you're reading that Contenders book by Dr. Mark Newman. Let's have a discussion about it. And by the way, I am the PhD of philosophy over here at the area university. I'm going to teach you a really important, very humbling, and that's a good thing, phrase that you need to learn how to say with great regularity, at least on occasion. I want you to learn it, so repeat after me. I don't know, but I'll find out. The second part's important. There's nothing wrong with telling people you don't know, but you'll find out. What we have in this world, by the way, if you're on social media, isn't it amazing how every single time a new issue comes up, there are suddenly hundreds of millions of absolute experts on that, whatever that topic is. Right? So, I mean, when Obamacare came down the pike, everybody was a public health expert. Right now, abortion's on the line, and everybody is suddenly an embryologist and a moral philosopher. That you're going to face garden variety stuff, and we're going to show you how to fix this. Now, I want to go ahead and start at the beginning, which is the best place always to start. Some of you have been told that the case for regarding abortion, the whole argument about abortion, is a very, very complex issue. It is not a complex issue. It is made to be a complex issue by our opponents. But the case for life can literally be boiled down to 3 short sentences. Some of you have had philosophy class. Some of you have had a logic class. Most of us are familiar with a kind of an argument called a syllogism. And if you don't think that you are, I'm going to give you one, and I'll bet it'll be really familiar to you. All men are mortal. Socrates is a man. Therefore, Socrates is mortal. That is a syllogism. A syllogism is an argument where, if the premises are true and the argument is constructed validly, the conclusion of that argument is inescapable. So here is the case for life. It is wrong to intentionally kill an innocent human being. By the way, almost everybody will stipulate that it's wrong to intentionally kill an innocent human being. And by the way, if they won't, move away slowly, right? It is wrong to intentionally kill an innocent human being. Abortion intentionally kills an innocent human being. Therefore, abortion is wrong. Right? Fairly simple. Now, you're not going to get a lot of pushback initially on that first contention. It's that second premise, right, that abortion intentionally kills an innocent human being. That's where you're going to get some pushback, and so that's where we're going to focus our time at the very beginning. What we're going to do is we're going to start with the scientific case for life. So, the question is, right, if it is wrong to intentionally kill an innocent human being, and then I'm going to argue that abortion intentionally kills an innocent human being, I have to prove two things. The first thing I have to prove is that what's in a woman's body from the moment of conception is a separate, whole, distinct, living human being. The second thing I have to prove is that abortion intentionally kills that human being. If I can prove that, then I have established that premise. So, are the unborn human beings? So, at the clinic and even at the popular level, what you run into a lot is abortion choice advocates. They assert that human beings are nothing more, at their conception, are nothing more than a blob of tissue. They are an undifferentiated cell mass. They are the products of conception. Planned Parenthood, on their own website, listen to how they describe an aspiration abortion. This is where they go in and they basically suck the baby out of his or her mother's womb. Listen to how they describe it. The doctor or nurse will use a small handheld suction device or suction machine to gently take the pregnancy tissue out of your uterus. They may also use a small surgical tool called a curette to remove any tissue that's left in your uterus or check to make sure your uterus is totally empty. Did you get that? They didn't even have the guts to say embryo or fetus. They called it pregnancy tissue. Well, let's see what science says. Remember, haven't you been being told all this time, right? Listen to the science, right? You know, when I want to find out about embryos, the people that I go to are embryologists. These are the kind of scientists that study the development and growth of embryos, in this case, human embryos. Well, there were some embryologists, Moore, Prasad, and Torchip, in the latest edition of their long-standing textbook, The Developing Human Clinically Oriented Embryology. This is a book that has actually been in print for a long time. I've seen numerous iterations of this book, right, different editions. This sentence has never changed, or if it has, not by very much, and the intent of it has never changed. This is what they write. Human development begins at fertilization, when a sperm fuses with an oocyte to form a single cell, the zygote. This highly specialized, totipotent cell, capable of giving rise to any cell type, marks the beginning of each one of us as a unique individual. So, when did your individual human life begin? Well, according to embryologists, it occurs at fertilization, right? Which we also refer to as conception. But they're not the only ones who know this. Geneticists know this. Dr. Jerome Lejeune, he was the professor of fundamental genetics at the University of René Descartes. This is the guy who discovered the genetic basis for Down syndrome. Okay? Listen to what he said. He's testifying before the Subcommittee on the Separation of Powers of the U.S. Senate Committee on the Judiciary back in April 23rd, 1981. Okay, so Moore, Prasad, and Torchia, 2020. This, 1981. At 2 months of age, the human being is less than one thumb's length from the head to the rump. He would fit with ease into a nutshell. But everything is there. Hands, feet, head, organs, brain, all are in place. His heart has been beating for a month already. Looking closely, you would see the palm creases. With a good magnifier, the fingerprints could be detected. Every document is available for a national identity card. The human nature of the being from conception to old age is not a metaphysical contention. In other words, it's not something that relies on faith to believe. It's not a spiritual claim. He says it is plain evidence. 1981. This is a flip chart from 1951. It's called The Gift of Life. If you were close enough, you could see that it's people going to or coming from church on the front. So, see, back in the day, in churches would actually use these things to teach sex education, something I wish churches would still be doing to some degree these days. So, because otherwise we're leaving it up to the world to do it. I'd love to tell you we're leaving it up to parents to do it, and it would be great if all parents did, But if our parents aren't, then the world is going to. But listen to what they write here. It's going to sound eerily familiar. If one of the male sperm meets and unites with an egg cell, a new life begins. That's 70 years of evidence all saying the exact same thing. One interesting distinction, though. This pamphlet, it was distributed by the Planned Parenthood Federation of America. This is what Planned Parenthood told everyone in 1951. When does human life begin? At conception. Everybody knows it. They're not the only ones. California Medicine, which is the official journal of the California Medical Association. This was back in 1970, 3 years before the Roe v. Wade decision legalizing abortion in the United States. They wrote in A New Ethic for Medicine and Society, listen to what they wrote about. They said, they talked about the curious avoidance of the scientific fact, which everyone really knows, that human life begins at conception and is continuous, whether intra or extra uterine, until death. Who knows when human life begins? Everyone knows, he says. Way back in 1970, back in 1951, they knew. Planned Parenthood knew. Geneticists know. Embryologists know. Everybody knows. So when you hear people say, as Joe Biden just did yesterday, that there's no consensus on when human life begins, it's just a medical lie, because it is a fact that human life, every individual human life, begins at conception. And not only, and the reason I call it a lie and not a misstatement is, you can't be president of the United States and not have access to the kind of information that a university professor has. So we've established that what's in the woman's body at the moment of conception is in fact a real, live, whole, separate, distinct, living human being. Does abortion then kill that human being? Well, abortion clinics try to hide that fact by using terms such as, well, they call what's in a woman's body, well, the embryo or the fetus, as if an embryo and a fetus was something other than a human being. They talk about, well, we're just going to terminate the pregnancy. In other words, we're going to stop a process that has begun, like you would shut off your lawnmower. They'll talk about evacuating the uterine contents, but they rarely talk about what it is that is being evacuated. And then, of course, as you saw from the Planned Parenthood website, they're going to gently remove the pregnancy tissue. First thing you need to understand is that embryo and fetus are just arbitrary labels for stages of human development. It is no, to call somebody an embryo or a fetus is no different than to call somebody a newborn or a toddler or a tween or a teenager or a young adult or a middle-aged adult or an elderly adult. All those things are, they're just stages of human development. But for some weird reason, we've got this idea, kind of like maybe we got it from Harry Potter, that if you say things in Latin, it has some magical property. But the fact of the matter is, by the way, any Latin speakers here, anybody know what the word fetus means, what it actually means? Anybody know? Want to take a stab at it? Nobody? I don't have a single Catholic in here. Yes, sir. Very close. Yeah, it can mean that, but directly it just means little one, meaning little one of us. A fetus, by the way, is a little one. So if you have a dog fetus, it's a little dog. But if you have a human fetus, it's a little human. So that's all it means. It's just a little one or child. That's all it means. So people use it like it's got some kind of magical property to it. It doesn't. It just means a little one. By the way, intriguingly, for many, many years, when a woman was pregnant, they said she was with child. Everybody knew it. Everybody's always known it. They talk about, well, I'll just let them speak for themselves. Here's a brochure. It is called Plan Your Children for Health and Happiness. It is a question and answer format about birth control. So they ask the question, birth control. They say, is it an abortion? Listen to what they write. Definitely not. An abortion kills the life of a baby after it has begun. It is dangerous to your life and health. It may make you sterile so that when you want a child, you cannot have it. Who wrote that inflammatory bit of rhetoric? Why, look, it was the Planned Parenthood Federation of America. This is what Planned Parenthood taught everyone prior to 1963. Now, some of you are looking at this right now, I know, going, but the young people are going, dude, that looks really Photoshopped, right? I get it. That's why it's so cool that I happen to own an original. So when I debate this, and people accuse me of that, I just pull this one out, rusty staples and all. How do I know that this thing came out prior to 1963? Well, on the back, there's an address for the Planned Parenthood Federation of America, and it is missing a zip code. Zip codes were introduced in 1963. I also happen to know that this wasn't a one-off. They printed this one, and they printed this one at two separate dates. How do I know? Because the wording is just a little bit different in this one. In this one, it says, definitely not, an abortion requires an operation, and then it says, an abortion kills the life of a baby after it's begun. They didn't back off on the claim that abortion kills the life of a baby. They just added another sentence. So I know that they had at least two iterations of this pamphlet, and I happen to have a photocopy of one and an original of the other. By the way, those of you sitting close enough, can you notice the racial makeup of the child on the cover of this? See, back then, Planned Parenthood wasn't about aborting black children, but they were trying really hard to make sure there were fewer and fewer of them. Margaret Sanger, by the way, even Planned Parenthood, finally came out and admitted, after they'd been pressed on it for ages, finally admitted that Margaret Sanger was a full-blown racist and a eugenicist, and she is, in fact, the founder. And I will never forget cringing to pieces when Faye Waddleton, a black woman, was handing out the Margaret Sanger Award on television. I could not believe it. To me, it would be like Elie Wiesel, the Nazi hunter, be like him handing out the Joseph Goebbels Award. I mean, it was mind-blowing to me. So, experts understand that embryo and fetus, they're just terms for human development. Planned Parenthood admits that abortion kills. They're not the only ones. Remember that little bit I read you from California Medicine, the official journal of the California Medical Association? Let me put that in context for you. This is a larger piece of that article. Since the old ethic has not yet been fully displaced, it has become necessary, or has been necessary, to separate the idea of abortion from the idea of killing, which continues to be socially abhorrent. The result has been a curious avoidance of the scientific fact, which everyone really knows, that human life begins at conception and is continuous, whether intra or extra uterine, until death. The very considerable semantic gymnastics which are required to rationalize abortion as anything but the taking of a human life would be ludicrous if they were not often put forth under socially impeccable auspices. It is suggested by the authors that this schizophrenic sort of subterfuge is necessary because while a new ethic is being accepted, the old one has not yet been rejected. I'm going to get you a copy of this entire essay. It's not that long. You can read it. These people fully understood that what they were doing is they were getting rid of a Judeo-Christian ethic which said that all human beings have objective moral value. In other words, every single one of you objectively has value. And they said we have to reject that and we have to receive a new morality that says that every human being has relative value. Now, intriguingly, who is going to be the arbiter of who does and doesn't have value? Why, doctors. So they say that in order to be at the forefront of death selection and death control later on, they now have to establish themselves at the forefront of birth selection and birth control. This happened in 1970, folks, and you know what? They did it. And it worked. How did they manage it? Well, they told a lie, right? A schizophrenic sort of subterfuge. That's planned lying. And they did it because they knew, they had to do it over and over and over again because they knew that intuitively everybody knew it was a human being, right? Back in the 70s, women would wear these big stretchy shirts and have an arrow pointing down on it, right? And over the top of it, it would go, uterine contents down here. No, undifferentiated cell mass, this way. No, excuse me, what did it say? Baby, everybody knows it's a baby. So in order to overcome this natural intuition, they said that they were going to have to put this lie forth often under socially impeccable auspices. We have to get the government to say it. We have to get the educational establishment to say it. We have to get the medical community to say it. We have to get the entertainment folks to say it. And it would be really great if we could get some clergy to say it. And by the way, they succeeded in getting those people to say it. See, they believed that a whole new world was being ushered in. It worked. And this is now the worldview that that those of us sitting in this room now must go out into and battle, because it is the worldview that most people, or a substantial number of people in America today, believe. By the way, there's no such thing as pregnancy tissue. Can I clarify that for you? Pregnancy is not a thing like a dog or a cat or a child. Pregnancy is just a condition. Conditions don't have tissue. Beings have tissue. But you'll notice how hard they work to not use the word being anywhere in their definition of an aspiration abortion. Because that pregnancy tissue that they say is going to be gently removed is actually a suction device which tears small children literally limb from limb. It's not gentle for the child. And as many women who've gone through post-abortion counseling, and men also can tell you, it hasn't been all that gentle for them either in the aftermath of things. By the way, abortion choice advocates, most of them, they just agree. Camille Paglia, no friend of the pro-life movement, but a nationally recognized academic, in Salon Magazine, September 10, 2008, so this is 14 years ago, listen to what she wrote. "Hence, I have always frankly admitted that abortion is murder, the extermination of the powerless by the powerful. Liberals," she is one, "for the most part, have shrunk from facing the ethical consequences of their embrace of abortion, which results in the annihilation of concrete individuals and not just clumps of insensate tissue." By the way, it debates. You can't find anybody who is a professional abortion choice advocate. You can't find anybody who will tell you that what's in a woman's body is not a human being. And the reason why they won't do it in a debate is because they know they're going to get shot down in just a matter of moments by an avalanche of evidence that demonstrates that that argument is not true. Nevertheless, right, we still have people making that argument out in public. Finally, remember I told you about David Boone and this big, thick book he has where he's making the argument that abortion is morally permissible? Here's the weird thing. I think he really gives away the whole game right in the preface of his book. You know the preface, that part that nobody ever reads? That part? Listen to what he writes. He talks about photographs of his son Eli. His son Eli is playing at the beach. His son Eli is rolling around in the grass. Then he writes this. He says, "In the top drawer of my desk, I keep another picture of Eli. This picture was taken on September 7, 1993, 24 weeks before he was born. The sonogram image is murky, but it reveals clearly enough a small head tilted back slightly and an arm raised up and bent with the hand pointing back toward the face and the thumb extended out toward the mouth. There is no doubt in my mind that this picture too shows the same little boy, Eli, at a very early stage in his physical development. And there is no question that the position that I defend in this book entails that it would have been morally permissible to end his life at this point." At what? Oh, at a point where you have a head, an arm, a hand and a thumb, and a mouth. You know, it's really funny. I look at this sometimes and I think, okay, 1993, 29 years ago. I really wonder how Eli feels knowing that his father made the argument that there was a point in his life when it would have been okay to end it. And as you're going to find by the time I'm done, the very arguments that Boonen makes in this book not only would have made it okay to kill Eli back then, but I'm going to show you how they lay the fundamental philosophical groundwork to potentially end the life of every single person in this room if the conditions were right. Now, folks, one of the difficult things that you're going to have to struggle with over the next few months is that you're going to be hearing a lot about the abortion issue, right? The abortion issue. And that's how we think about it often. We think about it as, oh, it's an issue, like a lot of other political issues, like where should we put the sewage treatment plant, or what should our attitude be about food stamps, right? Those kind of issues. I really need to disabuse you of this, because it's a prevalent thought in the minds of most average Christians in particular and Americans in general, that abortion is just a political issue like a host of other issues, And therefore, we have to just look at it as one of many issues. You'll hear people say all the time, I vote on all kinds of issues. You know, abortion is just one issue. The guy's with me on all kinds of other things. I could probably overlook that because, you know, if he's got six issues and I disagree with him about abortion, but I agree with him on five other issues, well, I'll go with him anyway because, after all, that's 5-1. I need to disabuse you of this, and doing so is, abortion is not an issue. Abortion is an act of violence that takes the life of an unborn child. You can go on the Discovery Channel and you can see people doing colonoscopies. You can watch somebody getting their arms sewn back on their bodies. But even though abortion is one of the most common surgical procedures in the United States, no one has ever seen an abortion on the Discovery Channel. Even though this is one of the hottest issues on the planet right now, not a single news station is going to show you an abortion. I'm going to tell you later on about a woman named Emily Letts, and she filmed her abortion, but I'm going to tell you right now, she did not film her abortion. I'll explain that when I get to it. But I would be not living up to my obligations if I did not show you what an abortion does to a baby's body. Now, what you're about to see, if you choose to see it, is very graphic. I'm going to warn you in advance as I put it up. If you do not want to look at this, please put your head down. Don't look at it. There's no description. There's just some music in the background. Don't look. But I'm telling you, if this is too hard to look at, then the thing that produces those images should not be countenanced in a free republic. Go ahead and play it. For some of you, this is the first time you've ever seen anything like this. I've been watching this video over and over and over again for over a decade. Every time I see it, it bothers me. And it should bother you. There are times when I get tired of being on the road all the time. I kind of miss my wife, my kid, who's living at my house with us. And whenever I do an apologetics class and that video comes on, I know why I am here. And I'm hoping it's going to help you to know why you need to go out and not just treat this as your average everyday evening class at church. Because there are real victims in abortion. The things that I can't show you here is I can't show you an appointment with a post-abortive mother who regrets having done that to her child. I can't show you meetings I have had in my office with post-abortive fathers who wanted their children but could do absolutely nothing to stop their children from being aborted because the man has absolutely no right and no ability to save their children from abortion. If the woman wants to, she can, and he can't do anything about it. And so this world is filled with damaged people. 1 out of every 3 to 1 out of every 4 pregnancies end in abortion in America. We have killed over 63 million children in this country since 1973. I have been in jurisdictions in the United States where the number of abortions actually exceed the number of live births. This is what we're up against. It is not an issue. It's a real, and you know, a lot of people talk about wars and fighting all the time, but this is an issue where there are real human casualties. And the only thing standing between an unborn child and that end is your voice and your ability to convince others to join you so that they will do what is right. If we can manage that, I think that we can build a life-affirming community right here in the Rock Hill area, all throughout South Carolina, hopefully in my state in Tennessee, Florida, Texas, many other states. We have other people out there, California, Illinois, New York, and New Jersey, have already codified Roe versus Wade into their legal system. And I believe that we're going to set up a dichotomy in this country between life-affirming states and life-denying states. And I will be praying fervently that God will rain his blessings down on those who choose to protect the smallest of his image bearers, and that God will bring calamity on those other states until they can look and see the difference and realize they are doing wrong. Folks, I would love to give you a break right now because we're at the end of one section, but I'm cruel, so I won't. I'm going to move us into section two. We'll not be able to finish this before we take a break, but if I stop now, you guys will get used to having breaks, and I'll lose my reputation as the meanest professor on campus. All right. So real quickly, I do want to help you to underscore the limits of science and the need for philosophy. Okay, remember, all we've proven so far is that what's in a woman's body from the moment of conception is a real, live, whole, distinct, living, separate human being. Okay? What we haven't been able to do is to determine whether or not we should value that human being. Right? Because science can't do that. Science is only good at counting stuff and measuring stuff and telling you what something is. It's not very good at telling us how we ought to value things. So, the one thing we can get out of science is when human life begins. So when does human life begin according to the science? At conception. That's where every individual human life begins. By the way, please do not get suckered in. People will go, oh no, life's been going on for millennia. It's just a constant flowing stream. Don't get sucked into that. That's a red herring. When did your particular individual human life, because that's what's going to, abortion doesn't kill the stream of human existence. It kills a single living distinct human being, just like each one of us, right? So that's the limit. Now some of my students have what I will call a construction view of how human life begins. They have this idea that down the umbilical cord, it comes down like Legos, right? Here's a little arm, here's a little body, you know. Or they have a Jiffy Pop popcorn view of human life, where you put the kernel in the, a seed is planted in a woman, and suddenly, 9 months later, you know, you get a baby. It's not how that works. Human lives develop inside of the wombs of their parents. So it's not like a car where, it's really hard to figure out at what point does a car become a car, right? Is it when the chassis rolls out? Well, no, it's got to have at least have wheels. Well, if it's got wheels, is it a car yet? No, it doesn't even have a seat. You can't even sit in it. If it's got a seat and a chassis and wheels, the most you've probably got right now is a go-kart, right? There's a lot of things that have to happen, and then it rolls off the assembly line. Now you've got a car because it was constructed. Human beings aren't like that. At conception, mom and dad's DNA zip together and form a completely new and distinct human being. Not the mom, not the dad. By the way, that's why nobody is a fertilized egg. Fertilized eggs don't exist. The minute conception occurs, you no longer have the egg. The egg's gone. Now you have a new human being in its place. Every single one of you started as a single cell called a zygote, which, if you'll recall from War, Prasad, and Torture, is a highly specialized, totipotent cell. That means a kind of cell that just that cell can give rise to all of the other individual cell types in your body, like skin tissue and eye tissue and neural tissue. That one cell is able to do that. Now, some people will make the argument, yeah, but you're not even as big as the period at the end of a sentence. But we're going to talk about that size argument later on. Doesn't make any difference. You started your life the day that sperm and that egg united. So we're going to shift gears. That's what the science can tell us, is what you are. What is it? This is not a trick question, so just leap out with it. What is it that everyone says makes all human beings equal? And we all agree, right, there's a lot of disparity in this room. Some of you are bigger than others. Some of you are smarter than others. Some of you run faster than others. I would argue that anybody under the age of 40 runs faster than me right now. But there's one thing that makes all of us, everybody in the room, equal. What would that be? Okay, from a biblical perspective, it would be that all human beings are created in the image of God, and that would make all of us equal. Now, if I'm going to speak, though, at a college or university campus that's secular and they're going to reject my biblical interpretation of humanity, what would everybody agree makes us all equal? What does every single one of us possess equally? We all have life, but there's lots of things that are alive. That's a religious argument. Humanity. Right? You have, no, not everybody's conscious. I plan on being unconscious here in about 5 or 6 hours. And when they did a rotator cuff surgery on me, I was completely unconscious, thankfully. But we all have a shared humanity. We have a human nature, right? Every person in this room has a shared human nature. And by the way, you have that human nature whether you can express it fully right now or not. You have it by the nature of the thing you are. You have a human nature. So now, not all life is equal, right? Somebody said life, not all life is equal. Human lives matter more than other lives. I can demonstrate this to you. For starters, even vegetarians kill and eat plants. And plants are alive. Somebody's going to go, I'm a fruititarian. It's okay. You just stopped all kinds of other life from coming in unless you spit all the seeds out carefully into something that's fertilized and nice. Christopher Kaiser, in his book, he gives an example. So you're coming here to this session, and you're running a little late, and so you're speeding a little bit. And then all of a sudden, you hear that fateful, you know, ba-dum-ba-dum. How many guys have ever heard that sound? Of the little squirrel or the bunny going under your car. How many guys have had that happen? A few of you? Okay. It's terrible, right? It's just terrible. So, of course, you immediately stopped your car, jumped out, checked to see whether the little critter was okay, and oh my gosh, he's not breathing, and so you performed CPR and began blowing into the mouth of the little bunny. No? You didn't do that? No, you know what you did? You did this. Aw. Okay? Now, let's change the account just a tad. Mix up the scenario. You're late here. You're speeding a little bit. You get distracted for just a second. You hear that fateful boom, boom, and you look in your rearview mirror, and there's a 4-year-old boy laying in the road. Now, I'm going to tell you what you're going to do. You're going to stop that car. You're going to get out. You're going to render every conceivable possible aid to that child. You're going to call 911. You will not leave the scene until the EMTs and the police arrive, and you can give a full statement, because if you don't, you're going to jail. Why? Because human lives are more important and are more valuable than rabbit and squirrel lives. There are people, by the way, out there who would argue that is not true. I'd love to have conversations with them, because even though they'll say it, none of them act that way. They all act like human beings. It's like people who tell me, there's no such thing as universal values. I just steal their wallet. It's amazing how suddenly they can think of universal values, like you're not supposed to steal people's stuff. That was funny, by the way. You guys are all going, is that going to be on the test? Yeah, I get it. All right. If you go out and there is a dumpster, you know, you live in an apartment like my wife and I did when we were first married, and you take out your trash and you put it in the dumpster, and you notice something rattling around in the dumpster. You don't know what it is, so you go out and you grab your shotgun. Do you start blasting away into the dumpster? No. What's the first thing you want to find out before you pull the trigger? What is it? Right? Because if it's the neighbor kid, you should not unload. If it is a raccoon, maybe. If it is a rattlesnake, definitely. Right? But we always want to find out what something is before we try to determine whether or not we should be able to kill it. So, under the concept of natural law, all human beings have a thicket of rights that surround them in order to protect them. But the first among those rights is always the unalienable right to life. Because if you're not alive, those other rights and privileges you should have, they don't matter. So the first and foremost right that you have is an unalienable right to life. So you'll notice in the first section on the science, I already proved that what's in a woman's body from the moment of conception is a real, live, whole, separate, distinct human being. And so what that means is, if it is wrong to intentionally kill an innocent human being, and then, as I've just proven, abortion in fact intentionally kills that innocent human being, then abortion is wrong. We should be done now, right? But see, what happens is our opponents, they engage in what I call a shift of thinking. They start backtracking on that first premise. Remember when I told you they would stipulate it, right? It's always wrong, right? It is wrong to intentionally kill an innocent human being. Well, suddenly they'll start going, well, by human being, I really meant a human person. And so if you're not a person, then this stuff doesn't count. It's what I call the first big shift from human being to person. Why do they do it? What's the reason they give for doing this? I'm going to tell you right now, the sole purpose of this argument, it only has one purpose. The purpose is to create a class of human beings that it is morally permissible to kill. That's the whole purpose of the argument. If only some human beings are persons, that means that other human beings are human non-persons. Now, there are all kinds of problems with this, but I want to start by examining what standards they use to justify this position. Stephen Schwartz, in his book, I should have brought it with me, he lays out a criteria that can be placed as an acronym. And the acronym is the word SLED, S-L-E-D. My friend Scott Klusendorf has really popularized this. By SLED, I mean all of the arguments that they have are going to fall into four categories: size, level of development, environment, and degree of dependency. So by size, I mean they will simply say you're too small. Now, this is a book by Katha Pollitt. Please don't buy it. It's one of the worst written books I've ever seen. Any one of my freshman debaters could have planted her with no difficulty. It's a very badly reasoned book. Katha Pollitt in this book says, of course you're not a person. I mean, on the day that you are conceived, you're no bigger than the period at the end of the sentence. And she says that as if it proves something. But there are a lot of people who believe this, that you must hit some kind of arbitrarily determined size before you count as one of us. What about level of development? Some people will argue, David Boonen actually presents a fairly complex argument that says that what makes you a person are the things that you can do. We have a standard for what constitutes personhood, and it includes things like sentience, in other words, you can think, self-awareness, the ability to communicate and form relationships, right? Stuff like this. And that if you don't have those things, if you are not sufficiently developed, then you don't count as one of us. Third, we have environment. This means where you're located. You've heard many people say, my body, my choice. So what the argument that they're making by making an argument like this is that the unborn child is actually a part of the woman's body. That's why it's her body, her choice, right? And so since you are a part of another person's body, and this is a related argument to the development argument, and since you are not viable outside of that body, then you don't count as one of us. And then the fourth one is degree of dependency. They make the argument that since you are dependent on somebody else's body, therefore, you are not a separate person, you know, worthy of all of the rights and privileges that come with being a human person. I want to go ahead and evaluate those four claims and see whether or not they hold any water. Okay, I taught debate for a number of years, and one of the things that we try to teach debaters is whenever something really important is on the line, and you've got to decide whether or not something does or does not fit into that category you're going to do something to, it's a really good idea to have what we will call a bright line distinction. In other words, a razor-sharp edge where you can determine everything on this side of it isn't that, and everything on that side of it is that. You want to be really, really clear about what's included and what's excluded. So one of the problems with size is it's a very arbitrary standard, okay? Okay, I got a row of, see the four of you back there, the younger people? You know who I'm talking about, you and the three of you. Would you all stand up for me for just a second? Just stand up. I'm not going to pick on you, just stand up. Okay. Now, you might look at them and you'll notice that that young man, he is taller than both of those young ladies. Did you notice that? Immediately. Okay, you can sit down now. Now, does that mean that he is more valuable than they are? No. I got into an elevator once with Shaquille, or not with, with Magic Johnson from the Lakers, and I actually wrote a Bible study with A.C. Green, who was a Laker basketball player. He's huge. I shook his hand. His hand, like, took up my whole hand and most of my forearm. I mean, he was just this massive guy. Are Shaquille O'Neal and A.C. Green more valuable than me? On a basketball court? Sure. But in terms of whether or not we should live or die, do we have varying degrees of value in that category? No. If you ever read Dr. Seuss's Horton Hears a Who, you already know the answer to this question, right? Because a person's a person no matter how small, right? Just because, and by the way, babies are much smaller than anybody here in this room. And they just keep getting smaller until the day of their conception. But at every step of the way, it's still them. You once were at the development level of a zygote. You once were at the development level of an embryo. You weren't some weird thing called an embryo. It was you. You were just the size and at the development level of an embryo. So size is a really bad standard because we never know how big is big enough. By the way, I find it interesting. They go, you're just a clump of cells. And whenever anybody says that to me, I say, so are you. Everybody in this room is a clump of cells. We're just, you know, more highly organized, but we're still just a bunch of cells. How many cells do you have to be to count as a human being? Because babies have a lot fewer cells than I've got. I'm trying to lose some cells right now. But that's how that works. It's just different levels. So that leads us to level of development. Level of development is this idea that we all should have certain kinds of attributes in order to be counted as a human being. A lot of problems with this, too. Hate to keep picking on you, but you're just so right there for me. Young man, how old are you? You're 12. Okay. Any other people in here? Any other men in here under the age of 25? Up in the back. There you go. How old are you, sir? Okay. I have bad news for the two of you. You are not yet fully developed. Now, the guy in the back is looking over at me going, dude, I could outrun you like 10 days, and you could. But here's the deal. Your brain hemispheres have not yet zipped together. That doesn't happen until you're about 25, right? This is why a lot of young men have what we will refer to as hold my beverage moments. You know what I'm talking about? Okay? It's because they just aren't fully cooked yet. 8-year-old girls do not have fully developed reproductive systems. That doesn't make them less valuable than 18-year-old girls, right? How developed you are is a very bad standard for determining who is and who is not protected as part of the class of human beings. It's a bad, bad standard, and it literally puts a lot of us at risk. Some people are born, there's a guy that I speak, that's on the same speaker's bureau as I am, he has no arms or legs. And you know what? He's never going to get them, because in his developmental process, something went wrong. Does that mean he's not valuable? No, in fact, he's one of the most sought-after public speakers in the world. Very, very smart guy. Some of us have different intellectual capacities. Some of us have had our intellectual capacities enhanced by lots and lots of education. But that does not make those people more valuable than other people, right? We don't determine value on IQ level. I have an article in my files back home about a guy who was born with almost no discernible brain tissue. He had hydroencephaly. All his brain tissue was literally pressed up against his cranium. That guy, who was told by his parents I would never amount to anything, ended up, I believe, getting a master's degree in mathematics. How? I don't know. Pretty amazing, huh? So we don't know what's going to happen, and we don't know how developed you need to be. All I can tell you is that when we're going to decide life and death decisions, we better not have an arbitrary shifting standard about what constitutes as developed enough to be a human being. Otherwise, somebody may one day decide you don't meet that mark. Number three, environment. So let me show you something. See me walking across this stage? In the time it takes me to walk from here all the way over to here, I have traversed a space orders of magnitude farther than any of you traversed in order to get born, right? Getting out through a birth canal and then getting your umbilical cord snipped, maybe 7 inches, 10 inches, that's it. That's the whole thing. What in the world makes anybody believe that somehow that little 10-inch journey does something magical to you that turns you into a human being with moral value from a human being without any moral value? Right? It doesn't make any sense. Finally, what about degree of dependency? You know, it's really funny. In this country, we give more privileges, more protections to the weakest people. And as a matter of fact, we have Americans with Disability Act, right, where we really try hard to protect those who are more weak, more powerless than other people. And we do that everywhere except in the womb. Here's the deal, folks. In the womb, you have to be dependent. You don't have any other choice. That organ that women possess, your uterus, it has one function. It is a place for another human being to reside and develop. It's what it's for. It's the only organ I can think of that's literally for somebody else. So that's where you're supposed to be. It's not a weird, you'll hear people say, it's nothing more than a parasite. Number one, a parasite is always not the same species as the host. Number two, it's not a parasite, it's a child. And we have moral obligations toward our children to take care of them. And by the way, if a degree of dependency is a problem, you ever seen how dependent a newborn is? Matter of fact, my wife, could you just get back in there? You're a lot easier when you were in there, right? Because when you're in there, you don't have to change diapers. You know, your body engages in waste removal services. You don't have to put the baby to bed, right? The baby, you're going to walk around. The baby's going to go to sleep. Okay, let's be honest. Sometimes not always when you want it to. But as a result, my wife's abdomen was much more entertaining than television when she was later on in her pregnancy, right? You could see hands and feet and stuff. Kind of cool. So, but this whole idea of dependency, that you're dependent, babies are dependent. And guess what? Someday, if you live long enough, you're going to be dependent too. My mother-in-law, Ginny Sosby, came to live with us the last 2 years of her life. She had developed Alzheimer's, and we were getting ready to move her in already, and for some weird reason, she fell at her nursing home. Right before we were going to move her into the house, we bought this big house, and we brought people in, and the people at the hospital said that she was done, that she was shutting down, and so they actually took her IV out. Okay, so I am a doctor. I have a PhD. But I'm not a medical doctor, but I do know one really good medical term. So I walked in and I said, what's going on? You know, why isn't her IV? And they said, well, you know, she's shutting down. And then I looked over at the bag that was collecting her urine, and I noticed it was continuing to fill. I noticed that her wrists and her ankles were not swollen, which are signs that your body is shutting down. And so I looked at that nurse, and I said the one medical thing I know. I want that bag put back on her stat. Watched enough medical shows to know that means now. And they did. And did my mother-in-law shut down? Yes, she did. 2 years later, if we would have let them have their way, she would have been gone in a matter of maybe 48 hours. She came in, she moved in with us, we took care of her. The later parts of her life, she could not turn herself, she could not feed herself, she could not hydrate herself, she could not clean herself up. But at no period in time did she ever cease being my mother-in-law, Ginny Sosby. I told her stories. She told me stories. She was a happy Alzheimer's patient. Not all Alzheimer's patients are happy. You know, a lot of Alzheimer's patients hallucinate. She hallucinated babies. So you'd come in and sit in the chair. She'd go, don't sit there. There's the baby. And so you'd have to reach over, pick up the baby, right, the invisible baby. So it's not a bad thing if you got to hallucinate something. But she never stopped being herself until the day that she died, even though she was completely 100% dependent on us, more dependent in some ways than a child in the womb would have been. So dependency, size, level of development, environment, dependency, these are all terrible standards. And if they are true, if they are what separate human persons from human non-persons, you need to understand that every single one of you in this room, at some point in your life, you could be at risk. Even if your problem was only transitory, it might be that people just didn't want to take care of you, so they could just put you to death anyway. What if the idea was you had to have a certain level of sentience, and you slipped and you hit your head on, you slipped on some black ice, you hit your head on the curb, and suddenly you're in a coma. And people decide they just don't want to take care of you because you're awfully dependent, you're not conscious, so you're down two of these things out of four. Why can't we just put you to death? Well, lots of times, you know, a week later, people come out of it. But for a while there, you're not sentient. For a while there, you might even require a machine to be able to breathe. Maybe you'd be a human non-person by these standards. And by the way, in case you think I'm making this up and I'm trying to make you think, oh gosh, nobody would ever do that. When we get to the end of the evening, I'm going to show you not only will people do that, in Western nations, they are currently doing that. There is no morally significant distinction between the embryo you once were and the human being you are now that would have justified killing you then, but not now. Now, it's really interesting. We've been saying this. Scott and I and many other people have been using this line for ages. And we always thought it was kind of the kill shot line, right? Once you realize that there is no distinction between the embryo you once were and the human being you are now, that would morally justify killing you now, killing you then, but not now. Our opponents have literally flipped this on its head and have said, well, I know, but see, since we could kill you back then, we should be able to kill you now. And in the state of California right now, there is a law, AB 2223, working its way through their legislative system, and they say that they're not going to investigate fetal demise all the way up through the perinatal stage. Now, see, this is where we use medical terms to obscure facts. The perinatal stage is the stage from 20 weeks to 7 days post-birth, and in some medical literature, up to 28 days post-birth. What I'm saying is that over in California, they're working on a bill that will decriminalize infanticide. That's why I'm saying these kind of standards, they lead to really bad public policies. So once we identify the human being, that's when we take a break. So we've gotten through the first big shift, so let's go ahead and take a quick break. When I say quick, I mean I'll give you 10 minutes. So I want you to be back here at 10 minutes till, go eat some hors d'oeuvres, and I'm going to go grab some books and eat some hors d'oeuvres, and we come back, we'll probably blow through this for about 45 minutes. I'll give you another very short break, and then we'll finish all up. This second section, by the way, and some of you guys look at me, there's five sections here. The second section is the longest one. So take a quick break. I'm going to take one, too. I'm going to go grab books.
but there's a river running through. We're okay, we're okay. There's a river running through. We're okay, we're okay. There's a river running through. We're okay, we're okay. But there's a river running through. We're okay, we're okay. We're okay, but there's a river.
Got a lot on my mind. There's a lot of things I want back. There's a lot of me I don't like. But I call just as I am to you. And I know just what you're gonna do when I need grace. It's all my fault. You never push me away. When all my bridges have been burned, you make another way. When everyone is leaving, I can see that you're the one who sticks around. Everything I needed, I can see it. You're still the one who's reaching out when I need grace. Is not afraid to run. You don't hold back. You don't hold back. Not ashamed of the things I've done. You don't hold back. You don't hold back. Your love is not afraid to run. You don't hold back. You don't hold back. Not ashamed of the things I've done. I need grace. Yeah. When I need grace.
Creation groaning, yeah. Is a new creation.
trying to figure out what it means to be human. Flesh and bone, the spirit and the soul. If I cannot earn your love by trying to measure up, why do I think I'd lose it in the lows? Somehow you see through my heart, and you welcome me with open arms, just as I am. In the good, in the bad, you still understand, and you never stop loving me, just as I am. You've been patient with my wondering, always knowing what I need. With a gentle hand, you show me where to go. No, there hasn't been a moment you weren't calling out to me. I heard your voice and now I'm coming home, just as I am. In the good, in the bad, you still understand that you never just as I am, with the heart of the Father, and grace like no other. Oh, you'll never stop loving me, oh, just as I am. I just want to say thank you. I just want to say thank you, thank you, thank you for loving me. I just want to say thank you.
Touching every heart.
Okay, folks. Once again, if I had to stop right now, it's over, right? It is wrong to intentionally kill an innocent human being or intentionally kill an innocent human person. Abortion intentionally kills an innocent human being, and I've also demonstrated it kills a person because there's no distinction between a person and a human being. As a matter of fact, Christopher Kaiser, in his book, The Ethics of Abortion, he makes a remarkable and a wonderful claim. The claim that he makes is that 100% of the time, every single time in human history, a culture has made a distinction between human beings and human persons. Every single time, without exception, it has been determined that a moral catastrophe has taken place. I want you to think about it, right? During the time of chattel slavery here in the United States, they determined, right, that Africans weren't persons, not persons like other people, right? And so we felt free to do what? Enslave them and kill them, right? During the time of the Third Reich over in Nazi Germany, what happened? They determined that the Jews were not persons. You can actually look at some of the imagery that they put up. It's horrifying what they did, and said that they weren't persons. By the way, throughout human history, what we do is we just dehumanize other image bearers of God, and once we do that, we feel free to put those people to death and, in fact, do to them whatever we would like. So it's clear, right, that what's in a woman's body from the moment of conception is a real, life, whole, separate, distinct, living human being, and that all human beings are persons. And if that is true, then we should be done, but we're not, and we're not because the other side keeps throwing up what I will call smoke screens. Some of them are more effective than others. This next one is a very effective one, and it has to be handled very carefully. So, the first big shift, I said, was a shift from being human to the shift to being a person, right? And we determine, right, no, it's a human being, yep, it's a person. Every time we distinguish between human beings and persons, moral catastrophes take place. So then what happens is we engage in the second big shift. The second big shift is from personhood to exceptions due to the origin of conception. In other words, these are what people refer to as the hard cases, rape and incest. If you are in high school, if you're in college, you are going to hear these all day long. Now, the standards that are used for determining that women should be allowed to have abortions in the cases of rape and incest are primarily as follows. And if you have ever encountered anything other than these two categories, please bring it up during the Q&A and I'll be happy to answer your questions. By the way, some of you are looking at me going, answer questions, you're going to do that? Yeah, write your questions in your outline, and then there will come a time at the end, and I will answer all of them. The first standard that people use is the argument that you shouldn't have to carry a rapist's child because the woman was forced, right? The rape was non-consensual. And then secondly, because no woman should have a constant reminder of the rape. Let's say she gives birth to the child looks a lot like the father who's a rapist. And that woman should, that would be a constant reminder of the rape, and no woman should have to go through that. It's just like, it's like violating her over and over and over again, and that simply wouldn't be fair. So how do we respond to this? Now, some of you might be looking at me going, well, you're the debate coach, give me the arguments. You never start with an argument when the issue is rape and incest. We always start with empathy when the question is rape or incest. Because you have no way of knowing if the person who's talking to you are themselves a victim of rape or incest. Now, I'm going to make a distinction between a public environment and a private environment. In a private environment and in a public environment, it starts off the same way, which is the first words out of our mouth need to be sympathy. The first words need to be sympathy. And what I tell people is, hey, look, I don't know if you've been a victim of rape or incest, I need to let you know I am so sorry. Right, you have been a victim of a horrible, horrifying crime. The person who did that to you, if they are found, if they are, if they're arrested, if they are tried and convicted by a jury of their peers, then that person should face whatever is the highest level of punishment a state can dole out for a person like that. If you were a victim of violent rape, or if you are a victim of incest. Now, if I am in a public setting, like it's a debate, or I'm at a college campus giving a lecture, my next words would be, so, just for the sake of argument, I always preface it this way because it's really not my position, but just for the sake of argument, though, Let's say that I was willing to put forward a piece of legislation in California, for example, where abortion is legal through all 9 months of pregnancy for any reason whatsoever at taxpayer expense, and if the woman involved is a minor, without taxpayer knowledge or consent. Let's say I was going to put forward a bill and we were going to outlaw all abortions except those pregnancies that have arisen as a result of rape or incest. Would you join me in signing onto that piece of legislation? Would you join me in lobbying for that legislation at the Sacramento State House? And you're going to find out that 95% of the time, the person who used the rape and incest exception is going to tell you no. At which point, I will tell you, I get a little torqued. So I will look at that person and say, how dare you? How dare you use the pain and agony of rape and incest victims in order to score cheap political points using their pain as your ammunition? That's horrifying. You should be ashamed of yourself and shouldn't do it. Now, some of you are looking at me going, that seems kind of harsh because we're always taught to be so nice. I'm telling you that on the abortion issue out in the public sphere, we need to be ready to go on offense. Because remember those images you guys just saw? We are their voice. Now, you might have noticed I started that by saying, you know, for the sake of argument, because it's not my position. So what I'm going to say to them is, look, I understand it's a horrible, terrible crime, and I do believe that whoever perpetrates this crime should be punished to the full extent of the law. I'm totally on board with you on that. Absolutely. But the circumstances of our conception, that means any of our conceptions, the circumstances of our conception have no bearing whatsoever on what we are and how we should be valued. And then we run some thought experiments. My favorite one is what I call counting people. So, let's say a man violently rapes a woman. She conceives. So, there's the man, the woman, and then we, you know, and she conceives. So how many people are we talking about now? Based on what we learned from the science and the moral philosophy, how many people are we talking about now? Three people. Okay, so the rapist, guilty or innocent? If he really did it, guilty. Right? This isn't a trick question. Some of you guys look at me, it's a trick question. It's not. Rapist, guilty or innocent? Guilty. The woman, guilty or innocent? Some of you are looking at me like, what do you mean guilty? Of course she's innocent. Okay, good. The child that has been conceived, guilty or innocent? Okay. Now, I believe it's been since about 1968, it has become illegal to provide capital punishment even for serial rapists. So my question to you is, why is it that in this scenario, the only person who's going to be put to death is one of the innocent ones? Right? That doesn't seem fair. And by the way, abortion choice advocates go out of their way to make it sound like every woman who's ever conceived as a result of rape has always aborted her child. Not only is that not true, but in addition to that, the majority of women who give birth to children who were conceived after a rape parent that child. Now, she doesn't have to. She can always place that child for adoption. The key is we don't engage in capital punishment for the child when the child has done nothing wrong to exist. And here's the thing. Some people say, well, how in the world could she raise that child? Because she recognizes that that child is half her. It's her child. It's still her child, no matter what the other guy did. By the way, there are a fair number of bad men who are not rapists. There are a fair number of bad women who aren't either. We don't kill children because their parents aren't great. We punish rapists to the full extent of the law. A couple of other thought experiments. That, by the way, this is an intriguing thing to do on a college campus because this really winds people up. Let's say that a woman meets a man at a bar. What the guy doesn't know, and he's married, right? He's over there at the bar. He's just having a drink, right? Probably shouldn't be there, but he's there. Woman walks up to him. What he doesn't know about her is that she really wants to get pregnant. She's been looking for a particular physical type, and he's it. So she goes over, sidles up to him, and at first she tries to just, you know, do the standard, you know, flirtation stuff. And he goes, oh, you know, I think you're really nice, but, you know, I'm married, so, you know, that's not going to happen. And so when he looks away for a second, she slips something into his drink, and she and an accomplice grab him, and they haul him out. This is a bar in a hotel. They take him up to a hotel room, and he wakes up. He has had all of his clothing removed. He's tied down to the bed, and she comes over, and she begins to mess with him. And by the way, there are people who will tell you that a man cannot be raped. I'm telling you, all you have to do is look at the literature, and it is absolutely true that a man can be raped. So eventually, the guy just has a physiological response. He's telling her no the whole time. Don't, please don't do this. I'm married, I don't want to do this. But she forces herself on him, and he finishes, and she leaves with her accomplice. Now, fortunately, there were cameras outside of the bar and hotel that happened to catch a really good glimpse of her license plate. Now, it took them about 3 months, but the cops finally track the woman down. They find her, and sure enough, she's 3 months pregnant. And a paternity test demonstrates that's his baby. Does he, at this point, have a right to force her to have an abortion? By the way, on a college campus, this makes people's heads spin, right? But I'm going to tell you right now, nobody is going to say, or very few people are going to say, yes, that man should be able to force that woman to go in and have an invasive surgical procedure to put his child to death. But why? Aren't the reasons the same? He didn't mean to, didn't want to. He told her no the whole time. He was physically restrained. And by the way, in case you think I'm making this stuff up, in my book, which I've got out in the lobby, I'll talk about it in a little bit, I tell a story of a young man who was raped in that way. And not only was he not able to have her have an abortion, when she gave birth to the child, the judge dinged him for child support. Okay? So, no, people don't say that. Second thought experiment. What if a woman marries a guy? He's a great guy, right? She'd been married to him for 5 years. She's had 3 kids with him in those 5 years. And then in year 7, the black and whites come whipping up to his house, and they jump out, and they handcuff the guy and haul him away because he has been accused over the last 4 years of being a serial rapist. They finally caught up to him. The wife can't believe it. But she goes to the court, and woman after woman gets up and tells intimate details about her husband, so much so that she knows for a fact they are telling the truth, and it's him. He gets convicted. He's sent away for 25 years. And she goes home. And there are her 3 kids, all boys, every single one of them, spitting image of dad. She's never going to get the mental images out of her mind during the testimony. Can she put those children to death? Can we do that a little louder? No. Why not? Because they're human beings, right? That's why. Well, if we've already established that human life begins at conception, if we've already established that there's no distinction in terms of personhood between humans, there's no such thing as a human non-person, then everybody should get that degree of protection. So once the humanity of the unborn is established, once the personhood of the unborn is established, as in there is no distinction between persons and humans, we cannot punish one innocent human being for the crimes of another guilty human being. And I know that this is hard because, see, we've lived in a culture that for decades has used this as the standard for what would be okay, an okay reason to abort a child. But it's only because of our ignorance about fetal development and our inability to engage in reasonable moral philosophy that this has even been allowed to put forward. What this is it is purely, it's an emotional argument. They're playing on the fact that there is a woman before you that you can see, but a baby that you can't. And she is in distress, and it's the natural inclination of people to want to relieve people's distress. But I think if everybody really understood what relieving her distress would look like to the unborn child, they wouldn't do it. And here's the other interesting thing nobody ever wants to talk about. Getting an abortion does not unrape a woman. All it really does is it violates her again. So our culture should do everything it can to get around that woman, support her, help her in any way that she can. She's been the victim of a crime. She should have access to crime victim funding. And we should do everything we can to support her, whether she wants to keep that child and raise it or whether she wants to place that child for adoption. She should get the support that she needs. So once we've dealt with rape and incest, we get into what I call the third big shift. And this is one of the biggest sections. The third big shift goes from the means of conception to exceptions due to the impact of pregnancy. Now, I want you to understand something. We are so far away from the syllogism now, it's mind-blowing, right? We started off with the idea, right, that it's wrong to intentionally kill innocent human beings. Okay, it's wrong to intentionally kill human persons. All right, well, it's wrong to intentionally kill human persons unless they were conceived in a bad way. Oh, well, I guess not that either. So now we aren't even talking about the person we're killing anymore. Now we're basically really just saying, I don't want to have a kid around. And I know that sounds harsh, but let's look at the rationale that's being offered. So we'll start with the most common exceptions. The first one is what I call my body, my choice. We've already chanted that in here once. These are what are called bodily autonomy arguments. And by the way, doesn't that sound great? Doesn't everybody want to have bodily autonomy? I do. I want to be able to do whatever I want with my own body. But there are a couple of problems here. The first problem is, number one, we're not talking about the woman's body at this point, right? When does each human life begin? At conception. So now we're not talking about the woman's body. We're talking about the woman's body, inside of which is another person's body, which may, in fact, be a woman's body. Or freakily, may in fact be a man's body, inside the woman's body, right? Or a male body, or a female body, inside of her body. So it's not her body. And I'm getting ahead of myself, because what I want to do is just explain these first, and then I'll go through all of them. But that's the first one. The second one is the threat to the mother's life. Now, if you want to write, you want to just put a check mark next to that one, this is an odd one out. Basically, the argument is that sometimes women get pregnant, and they get pregnant in such a way that it literally places the woman's life at risk. For example, she has placenta previa, which is an example where the placenta grows over the woman's cervix. And if that happens, it can create a life-threatening condition. But the most common one that you hear about is an ectopic pregnancy. In an ectopic pregnancy, what happens is the most common one that people think about is when the child is conceived inside the fallopian tube and never makes its way down into the uterus. So it begins growing inside the fallopian tube. Now, if that happens, and that pregnancy is to continue, chances are great that both the baby and the woman are going to die. It's very, very dangerous. Third is a threat to a woman's mother's physical health. And actually, placenta previa kind of falls into that category a little bit better. There's another version of that called placenta. I'm going to probably butcher the Latin here. I think it's called acceta or acceta. It's A-C-C-E-T-A. This is where the placenta grows too deeply into the uterine wall. Some women have gestational diabetes when they get pregnant. So there's all kinds of things that can affect a woman's health, and they would argue, well, we don't want to put a woman's health at risk, so we want to make abortion available to them. By the way, so we look at some of these here and we go, well, that's why we always have those laws that say unless there's a threat to the woman's life or health. I'm going to give you a little heads up here. Whenever they use that word health, the way it's been used historically is they use the UN's version of health, which, by the way, includes physical health, emotional health, relational health, financial health. In other words, once you introduce the word health, you've literally blown the doors open for abortion on demand for any reason whatsoever. What about the threat to, I'm going to do some of these all together and I'm going to deal with them all together. The threat to the psychological well-being of the mother. Some women give birth and they have postpartum depression, for example. And that can be a very dangerous thing. Some women have committed suicide after giving birth because they just have some kind of imbalance or there's some kind of psychological disturbance going on, and so having children can radically affect women, some women. They'll get depressed. Lots of other things can happen. The threat to the economic well-being of the mother. She's got two kids. If she has another one, she doesn't know how she's going to be able to afford it. And so they would argue that because they can't afford to have another child, they shouldn't have another child, so we'll just abort that one. The social stigma that attaches to unwed motherhood, right? And I got to tell you, this is particularly acute in the church. And I'll talk about that in a minute. But this idea that if you get pregnant outside of wedlock, that makes you some kind of a fallen woman or you're a terrible human being. And so what we do is we abort that child so that we can get away from the stigma, and that way nobody will ever know that you were pregnant in the first place. The age of the mother. Well, that she can't have a child. She's too young. We can't have babies having babies. You've heard people say things like that. Or she's too old, and because she's old, she's likely to have a child with neural tube defects like Down syndrome, for example, or spina bifida. That leads me directly to number 8. What about fetal abnormality? Some people, they have amniocentesis. They find out the child they're carrying has got Down syndrome. They find out the child's missing arms or legs. They find out the child's got hydroencephaly. There's all kinds of things that can go wrong in the development process. And so people would argue, I don't want to deal with the stress associated with having a child that is severely disabled, so I should be able to go ahead and end that pregnancy by, and this is the part, they always say end that pregnancy, but I always want to add, by killing the life of the child inside their bodies. The unborn is an undesired gender. Now, some of you are looking at me like, what? But there are cultures in the world where they really want and value male children, and they really devalue female children. And when ultrasound was introduced, they did ultrasound, and if they found that the child was female, they would abort that child. And I'm certain that there are people in this country who are so vain and so pre-programmed, they will say things like, well, you know, we always wanted to go boy, girl, boy, girl. This first one's a girl, so we're going to go and abort this one, and then we're going to try again. The unborn child is unwanted, right? The ongoing slogan of Planned Parenthood is every child a wanted child. And what they argue is that if a child is unwanted, that unwanted child will be unloved. If the child is unloved, they'll probably, you know, maybe gravitate toward criminal behavior or something like that. In other words, every child deserves to be loved, so if you're not going to be loved, it'd be better if you just weren't here in the first place. And then one of my favorites, you shouldn't bring any more kids into the world anyway because the world is overpopulated. There are just too many people. Our planet is at carrying capacity. And you'll hear the climate alarmists right now yelling and screaming like human beings are a cancer on the planet. So how do we respond to all these arguments? By the way, we shouldn't have to, right? Because if it's wrong to intentionally kill an innocent human being, and we've demonstrated that abortion does that, the conclusion is that abortion is wrong. We've already done that. And now they're going, oh, and they're trying to come up with other excuses. But you know what? I'm willing to respond to their arguments and demonstrate that these are all bad also. Number one, my body, my choice, the concept of bodily autonomy, right? It's not the woman's body. A more complicated form of this argument is what's called Thompson's Violinist. I go into it in fairly good detail in my book. Christopher Kaiser goes into tremendous detail in his book. Thompson's Violinist, some of you have already heard this. And by the way, if you ever hear this on a college campus, it's really funny because I talk to undergrads who honestly think they thought this up themselves. This argument's been around for a long time. The simplest version of this argument goes this way. There is a guy, and he is a world-famous violinist, and he has got this blood disease, and they need to find a match to be able to filter his blood so that he can live. Now, with treatment, it's going to resolve itself in about 8 or 9 months. So what happens is a group of music lovers find a guy who actually is that match, and they kidnap him, sedate him, and when he wakes up in the basement of this hospital, he is connected to the world-famous violinist. Hospital administrator comes down and says, oh man, dude, I'm really sorry. We did not do this to you, but here you are. And I got to let you know, if we unhook you from this violinist, he's going to die. And so Thompson's argument is, are you morally obligated to lie on that table or be in that bed for the next 9 months before you can be unhooked safely in the violinist and you can go your separate healthy ways? And of course, the conclusion she comes to is obviously not. Nobody would be obligated to do that. The problem is this analogy, whenever you argue by analogy, the analogy has to be very tight, right? The two things you're comparing have to be very similar. So let's explore just a few of the ways in which these things are not remotely similar. Number one, how well do you know this violinist? Not at all. Never met the guy in your life. The child in a woman's womb is not a stranger. The child in a woman's womb is her actual offspring. The connection you have with the violinist is artificial. The connection you have with your unborn child through an umbilical cord is quite natural. As a matter of fact, like I said, the whole purpose of your uterus is to house, protect, feed, hydrate, and provide waste removal services and a safe place to live for this unborn human being. Parents have obligations toward their children. And let me give you a third one. I don't want to belabor this because we could go on just about that for almost an hour. Abortion is not being unhooked from somebody. Right? In this case, it sounds so antiseptic, doesn't it? Oh, you just go up and you unhook yourself, and then the violinist just dies. By the way, did you do anything to kill the violinist? No. The violinist is not dying from anything you did. The violinist is dying of the violinist's own disease pathologies. You're just kind of removing yourself. Abortion is not like that. Now, imagine the scenario if I said, as the hospital administrator, if you want to get out, we can get you out. But in order to do that, we have to bring in a guy with a chainsaw, and he's got to cut your violinist into pieces. And that will free you. I think a lot of people at that point would be looking at their calendars, seeing if they could manage 9 months. So when people understand the brutality of abortion, it puts the whole thing into perspective. Not only that, but in her scenario, they make it sound like you got to lie in a bed for 9 months. Now, I'm going to tell you, there are some women who have very, very tentative pregnancies, and they do have to, they're bedridden for months. Most women, they go about their business until maybe a week or so, and sometimes up until the day of their delivery, which, by the way, lasts approximately 40 weeks, unless you're my first son, in which case it was 43. Did not want to come out, man. Must have been really cozy in there. One day, I finally got up to my wife's abdomen, and they said, if you don't come out, we're coming in after you. And that day, the water broke, so I don't know. I am persuasive. So So that's the problem with this whole bodily autonomy thing. Also, by the way, you don't even have autonomy over your own body. I'll give you an example. Ladies, how many of you had difficult pregnancy? You threw up a lot. Hands up. Okay. So they call it morning sickness, right? But it's really afternoon, evening, all day long sickness. I get it. My wife was eating, you know, saltine crackers and almonds and stuff all the time. What if I told you, those of you who raised your hand, what if I told you I have a drug that will solve your problem? You can take it and you will not have, or it will severely decrease your morning sickness symptoms. Wouldn't that be awesome? Wouldn't you like to have that? Here's the fun thing. I have that drug. It exists. But you won't be able to find a doctor anywhere willing to give it to you. But wait a minute. What about my body, my choice? The problem is the drug will suppress your morning sickness. The problem is the drug is called thalidomide, and it led to severe birth defects among children in the womb. So the physician is not prescribing it, not for you, but for that other patient that he recognizes resides in your womb. By the way, the government's also really not fond of you going around putting crack cocaine in your own body, right? If you try to do it and they catch you, you're going to jail, at which point your bodily autonomy will be severely restricted. What about the threat to the mother's life? Okay, in an ectopic pregnancy, let's use that example. I use the word here called legitimate, and the reason I use the word legitimate is because I'm not going to classify what happens when a woman is treated with an ectopic pregnancy as an abortion. An abortion is the intentional killing of an unborn child. The intent is to end the life of that child, right, to terminate the pregnancy by intentionally killing the child. In an ectopic pregnancy, what happens is a physician will come in, they will open up the woman's abdomen, or they'll get at her fallopian tube, probably through endoscopy, and then they will, well, they couldn't do it through endoscopy, they have to go through the uterus, you want to do that. So they would, you can tell I am not a medical doctor, but what they will do is they'll clip either both sides of her fallopian tube and take that out with the embryo inside, or they will incise the fallopian tube and take the embryo out. In either case, the death of the child is foreseen, but it is not intended. The purpose of this is not to end this pregnancy. The purpose is to make sure that at least one of the people involved lives. Because if the child's allowed to grow, both of them are going to die. In order to preserve one life, they have to take the child out. Now, there may come a time when we will have, as I was talking with a gentleman earlier, we will have artificial wombs where it may be possible to transplant that embryo. But at the current state of medical science, that cannot be done. So it's not intentional. The focus is on promoting life, not ending it. Now, the next bunch I'm going to handle collectively. The threat to the woman's physical health, the threat to the psychological well-being of the mother, and the threat to the economic well-being of the mother. All of these arguments depend on an assumption. The assumption they all depend on is that the unborn is not a human being. How do I know this? Let's just use the economic example. If a woman had three children and suddenly lost her job and could not provide for all three of them, could she then kill the youngest one? No. Some of you are looking at me, what? What are you talking about? Of course they can't do that. What are you, some kind of a monster? Right? But if there is no moral distinction between the child in the womb and the child outside of the womb, in order to make this argument, you have to assume that the child that's being killed is not a human being. And we've already answered that question. The same thing would be true about the psychological well-being of the mother. Some women have children. Now the child's on the outside. They have postpartum depression. We don't just kill her newborn because she has postpartum depression. Same thing is true even about a woman's physical health. By the way, I know this is going to make a little light of this. When you have a toddler, you are going to get sick because toddlers do not engage in good body hygiene. Right? They don't, right? They walk up to you, they got snot all over their hands and dirt and God only knows what else, and they come toddling down. Mommy, mommy! You don't put them at arm's length and stiff arm them and knock them to the ground before you can hit them with a fire hose. You don't. You pick them up, right? And you cuddle them, and they get all of that all over you. I used to have to go to dry cleaners much more frequently when I had little children. We don't do that. Do your kids make you sick? Yeah, they do. Matter of fact, I can tell you, as a college professor, I got out of the habit of opening up. I would not put my hand on the doorknobs to my classrooms because I knew some of these guys, they did not wash their hands. So people get you sick. These are not good reasons to end the life of somebody else. So whenever people ask you, well, what about if a woman can't afford it? You do what we call trotting out the toddler. Just put a 2-year-old in front of them and say, could you kill that one for the same reason? No. Well, if we've demonstrated that what's inside and what's outside are morally equivalent, then if we can't kill the two-year-old, we should not be able to kill the child in the womb. Now, what about the social stigma that attaches to unwed motherhood? Like I said, one of the biggest problems is that the place that that mostly occurs is in the church. It's not nearly as significant as it once was in the world. Out of wedlock births are unfortunately very common, but now we actually celebrate certain celebrities when they have children out of wedlock. The stigma does not arise from the child. It arises from the actions of the mother and the father. We do not kill innocent people in order to cover up our own shame. Now, sometimes, how many pastors do I have here? We got one. Are you coming tomorrow? It's going to be a completely different thing tomorrow. Oh, you should come. It's going to be wild. I'll give you a little preview. I ask the pastors that I'm with in the morning, I'll ask them things like, wouldn't it be great for counseling purposes if every sin somebody committed had a corresponding physical manifestation? Seriously, imagine how easy it would be. Oh, gee, Greg, looks like you're still dealing with envy. You have a big green cloud over his head or something, right? And they start thinking that would be kind of cool until they realize it would include them. Suddenly, we're not so keen about that. The last people in the world that should ever look down their nose at a pregnant teenage girl are people in the church. Number one, there, but for the grace of God, go many of us. Number two, what's going on with that woman is not a sin. It's not a sin to be pregnant. It's just a biological fact. And you know what? Sometimes, you want to know how that happened? She was in love with this guy. The guy swore he was going to marry her. She was already planning her wedding, and they've been so good. They've been trying so hard to keep themselves morally pure. And then one night in the back of Dad's Chevy or whatever, they make a mistake. One time. And by the way, that's all it takes. And now what? We're going to, in my book, I talk about there are high schools that will kick her out of school, strip her of all the honors that she's earned. By the way, what are they going to do to the guy? Nothing. He probably doesn't even go to that school. So they will just punish her to pieces. And so you know what happens when we do that? You may as well just get in the car and drive her to the abortion clinic. When you make it so painful for people who have made a mistake, by the way, can I see the hands of all of the blameless people who can throw that first stone? You know, I find it fascinating in that story where Jesus is presented with a woman caught in adultery. Keep in mind, they caught her on purpose. They knew where she was going and what she was doing. They drag her in front of Jesus. Jesus says a really fascinating thing. He says, let he who is without sin cast the first stone. You want to know what the best part about that whole story is? It's not everybody getting embarrassed and walking away. It's that there was a guy there without sin. And he didn't cast the stone either. Jesus was the only person in that whole group who could have picked up a big rock and killed her right on the spot and been completely blameless about it by Jewish law. But he didn't. He extended grace and mercy to her. I have some pastors who tell me, we can't throw that girl a baby shower because then all the other teenage girls will want to get pregnant, which I go, you're an idiot. You're just an idiot if you think that. Okay. What did Jesus say to her? He said to her, you know, he forgave her, and then he told her to go and sin no more. You know, I think that's pretty good advice for pastoral ministry. That's what we ought to tell anybody who's caught up in sin, is find forgiveness through the shed blood of Jesus Christ and then go and sin no more. We got to do better. What about the age of the mother? She's too young or she's too old? You can always place those children for adoption. By the way, do you know that there is a waiting list for people to adopt children with Down syndrome? I was on the board of directors for an adoption service for about a year. We never failed to place a child for adoption, even crack babies who never made it out of the hospital. We were always able to find loving parents for those kids. So the idea that there's tons of kids who are not being adopted is a lie. Most of the kids in the foster care system that are not being adopted, there are roadblocks to them being adopted. So once again, just like in the rape example, these people are using something they know is not true to try to score cheap political points. What about fetal abnormality and the stress associated with it? You know what? Everybody with a healthy child, every single person, and I hope all your kids are healthy, is literally one accident away from having a kid with a special need. Right? Your kid who's number one on the hockey team, best quarterback on the football team, slips on some black ice, hits his head on a curb, and now he's going to be 8 years old for the rest of his life. Do we kill that kid now? Oh, no, you can't do that. Don't be a monster. The ADA will come in and help them out. So if that's the case later, why should it be the case earlier? It's inconsistent. It doesn't make any sense. The unborn child is an undesired gender. Now, I told you about the cultural distinctions, but for some people, the fact of the matter is, folks, especially here in the West, it's just shallow. It literally treats unborn people like a purse or some other accessory. The other thing you have to remember is that desires are fleeting. I know guys, right? Wife gets pregnant. I just can't wait to have my little man cub. He's going to be great. We're going to go out hunting. We're going to go out fishing. I'm going to teach him how to field dress a deer and put it up on the rack. Right? They got all these thoughts, right? And then they find out that little George is actually little Georgina. Right? But it doesn't take long for most guys, right? You guys see that there was a viral video that went around. And then the guy did a gender reveal and suddenly realized he was having his third daughter in a row. And he actually got upset about it. And I kept thinking, that's going to haunt you, dude, for the rest of your life. But my best friend, he only had one child. He got pregnant after years and years and years of infertility. Nobody could help him out. He went on a missions trip to Hungary with his wife. And at the age of 42, with no medical intervention, they got pregnant with the one child that they have. Beautiful little girl. But I could tell, you know, I had two sons, and he has a black belt in karate. He's a competitive tennis player, all that stuff. Now he watches Project Runway, and he did daddy-daughter dances. Right? It's amazing how fast people's desires change. That relates also to an argument I'm going to make here in just a second. What about the unborn child is unwanted or will become a problem for their self or society, right? Every child a wanted child. Okay, number one, every child is a wanted child. That a child is not wanted by their parents is a moral defect in the parents, not in the child. Every child's a wanted child. There's a massive waiting list for children in this country for people who want to adopt them. It also assumes that not wanting these children is an unalterable condition. It's not. May I see the hands of everybody associated with the pregnancy center? Raise your hand up. Okay, see all these people here? I will bet you have talked to people who walked in not wanting to have children, and then after a matter of weeks or months, suddenly couldn't imagine life without having that child. Right? That's because people have this weird idea. I want you to think about how predatory the other side is. In the moment of people's greatest weakness, they pounce, put them down a hallway, and do a procedure that takes a grand total of about 3 or 4 minutes, and that child is gone. They don't give them an opportunity to change their mind. People change their mind about this all the time. And if an embryo or a fetus can be killed because it will not be loved, why can't the born child be killed because it is not loved? There are a lot of people who plan children. Children don't turn out the way they wanted them to. There's a lot of conflict in the family. You don't kill those children. Love is not the standard for whether or not people have value as human beings. Finally, a little word about abortion and crime rates. There was a study that went around for a while. It was really wild. It argued that Roe versus Wade decreased the crime rate. And it did. You want to know why? Because it wiped out about 25% of all the kids that were going to be born that year. And so during the time period where those kids would have been between the ages of 16 and 26, when most males commit crimes, well, things went down because those people weren't there to commit them. But here's the deal. Would you be surprised if I told you that I could eliminate all crime in Rock Hill tomorrow? I could. I got a plan. It will eliminate all of the crime in Rock Hill tomorrow. All you got to do is kill all the people. If you kill all the people, there won't be any crime in Rock Hill tomorrow. But this is what people forget. It's true that some people who get born become criminals. But some people who get born become police officers who catch those criminals and become judges and jailers. Sometimes they become Sunday school teachers who get a hold of that person who would have become a criminal, introduce them to Jesus, and they become missionaries instead. Right? This is a terrible reason to use for engaging in abortion. Now, what about the idea that the planet is overpopulated, right? Jacqueline Kaysen wrote a great book. She's an economist, not a theologian or a philosopher. She wrote a book called The War Against Population. She determined that you could take the entire population of the world, place it inside of the confines of the state of Texas, leaving the rest of the world completely devoid of human beings, and that state would be less densely populated than many urban areas in the world. It's just not true. Get on a plane and fly from one coast to the other, and you know what you're going to see a lot of? Land. And we've gotten better and better and better at creating calories in this world. Thomas Malthus, over 100 years ago, made the argument that we were going to run out of food. Folks, we create more food per acre than we ever have in the history of humankind because all of these calculations always leave out one important thing, human ingenuity. God gave us a brain to solve problems, so we're able to solve these problems. It's just a terrible, terrible argument. And then one that's not listed here but I think I need to address is the idea that if abortion is made illegal, thousands of women will die. As a matter of fact, the number they came up with was 10,000 women a year. When you look at my book, you'll see the source citation. The guy who did that, Bernard Nathanson, he said they literally pulled that number out of thin air. Why? Because it was a nice, round, shocking figure. They knew it was a lie when they said it. And the fact of the matter is, it's never been true. Why are the numbers of women who died from abortion so much lower now than they were, say, in 1920? Because of antibiotics. What women were dying from were infections, and now that we have antibiotics, they don't. Abortion is a very, very safe surgical procedure for the woman having it. I'm not telling you that there aren't women who still die of abortions. They do. A perforated uterus, all kinds of other complications. But by and large, safe for the woman, completely and 100% nearly lethal for the child being aborted. So every single abortion is not safe because it kills another human being. So then we get into the final shift, what I call unmasking abortion extremists. It's a human being. It's a human person. Being a victim of rape or incest has no bearing whatsoever on the nature of the human being inside that body. There are no arguments that are out there that would make abortion okay that wouldn't make killing postborn people okay. So we shouldn't be doing this, and yet there are people here who, once you lay out this entire case, go, I don't care, I still want to have abortion. They're what I call abortion advocates. The other people I call abortion supporters, they don't really know why they support abortion, they just know that all the cool kids do. So when they encounter the evidence, some of those people can be persuaded. Abortion advocates can't be persuaded. They're going to be in favor of abortion no matter what. Let's take a look at some people like this. This is an article that appeared in Salon Magazine. The author of it is Mary Elizabeth Williams. This is what she writes toward the end of it. She says, and by the way, the article is called, So What If Abortion Ends Life? She says, in an op-ed on why I'm pro-choice in the Michigan Daily this week, Emma Manier stated quite perfectly that some argue that abortion takes lives, but I know that abortion saves lives too. Then she follows up. She says, she understands that it saves lives, not just in the most medically literal way, but in the roads that women who have choice then get to go down, in the possibilities for them and for their families. And I would put the life of a mother over the life of a fetus every single time, even if I still need to acknowledge my conviction that a fetus is indeed a life worth sacrificing. Now, what Mary is engaging in is a fallacy called equivocation. This fallacy occurs is when we use a word, the word life, we use it in two different ways and expect that the people listening to us won't see that we're doing that. So she says that abortion does save actual physical lives, and she's correct. In a case of an ectopic pregnancy, if you remove the embryo, the woman is going to live where otherwise she might die. But then she starts talking about the roads people get to go down and the choices they get to make, and now we're not talking about her physical life anymore. We're talking about her life style. But on the other end of the equation, where we have the child, we're only talking about one thing, not about lifestyle, but whether or not that human being will, in fact, physically live or die. And you're going to find it very fascinating that at the end of this, she uses that phrase, she says it's a life worth sacrificing, because I'm going to tell you in just a little bit exactly what that means. But you need to understand, this person doesn't care if it's a human life. She doesn't care if it's a human person. She just wants to have choices and believes that it's okay to kill other human beings if it allows you to get what you want. She's not the only one. Years ago, you used to hear people would say, abortion should be safe, legal, but rare. In fact, it's what Bill Clinton said in 1993. Tulsi Gabbard, by the way, tried to say that again in the last election cycle. She was savaged by the press, because here's the problem. As soon as you say that it should be rare, the natural inclination is for people to think, well, if it should be rare, that must mean there must be something wrong with it. And the pro-abortion crowd, they cannot admit that there's anything wrong with abortion. So the new slogan is abortion, on demand and without apology. And this is what you'll see on signs as people attend these kinds of rallies. Some people just absolutely revel in it. In Cosmopolitan magazine, May 3rd, 2014, abortion clinic worker Emily Letts, she was an abortion counselor at a clinic. And she kind of always felt bad because people would ask, well, have you had an abortion? And she always had to admit that she hadn't. So she was really excited when her boyfriend got her pregnant. She could have gone in for a chemical abortion. She could have taken a couple of pills and then had her abortion that way. But she wanted to have a surgical abortion. So she waited. In other words, she purposefully allowed her child to continue to develop past the six-week mark. Because you can't have a surgical abortion before 6 weeks because the baby's so small, you might leave pieces in the woman's body that could lead to to a life-threatening infection. So she waited till the baby was big enough. Then she went in and she had her abortion. But she didn't just have it. She filmed it. By the way, I watched that film. That film, by the way, won an award. She says she filmed her abortion, but she didn't. She filmed herself having an abortion. In other words, from the chest up. I found it intriguing that she had people holding her hands. She talked about how she had a lot of support. And I kept thinking, you know, when I had rotator cuff surgery, nobody held my hand and I didn't get any support till I got out. You want to know why? Because there's nothing wrong with somebody cutting into your shoulder in order to repair your rotator cuff. Why did she need support? And yet at the end of that video, you know what she says? She says, still, every time I watch the video, I love it. So she watches the video over and over again of the moment in which she voluntarily chose to extinguish the life of her unborn child. In Vice 2019, abortionist Zoe Thill puts on abortion workshops where she provides average everyday citizens with the kind of experience of performing an abortion. So she brings in aspiration equipment, and then she brings in a papaya to stand in for a human uterus, and she tells them to go put the cannula inside the papaya and let's try to extract the seeds. Now some people, they push a little too hard and it comes out the other end, and then she laughs, which is funny because if you really did that in a real abortion, it's called perforating the uterus and it's life-threatening. So she says, oh, she laughed, and we don't shame perforators here. Now some of the people get the cannula in and manage to extract the seeds, and they get all excited about their successful abortion, and this is what she says. Phil tells them, it's even more satisfying when it's a real abortion. We have people who are arguing for infanticide and involuntary euthanasia these days. I'll get to that in the last section. Folks, it's mind-blowing where we're at in this culture. We've got people lighting up buildings to celebrate the passage of laws to exterminate children. That's where we're at now in Western culture. I finally want to answer some questions about whether women should be punished under the law for having an abortion, because this is something people bring up all the time. They basically say, you know, all you want to do is punish women for having abortions. And what they want you to do, the objective of saying this, is to prove that pro-lifers either really don't value life because they won't punish the woman for murder, because most pro-lifers, when you see the legislation, they don't punish the woman, they punish the doctor. So they say, oh, you're inconsistent. If a woman was a hitman, you'd punish her. So when you encounter this argument, let me show you how to respond to it. Expose the fallacy. Say, just openly, okay, look, if I say I'm going to punish the woman, you're going to tell me that I'm anti-woman. If I tell you I'm not going to punish the woman, you're going to tell me that I'm inconsistent. So which is it? Right? This is a no-win scenario. So let's change things up a little bit. Let me ask you some questions. Can different kinds of intentional killing evoke different kinds of punishment? So let me give you three examples. There's a guy. He's a professional hitman. He gets up on tall buildings with a big sniper rifle, and he kills people for money. Scenario number one. Scenario number two, a woman comes home early from work. When she walks in, she finds her husband in bed with his secretary. There's a shotgun in the closet. She reaches in, grabs it, and unloads two shells, one in each of them, and kills them both. Scenario three, a man is going with his wife to the theater, and they take a shortcut through an alley. They are confronted by a robber who pulls out a knife, and he says, I want your wallet. The guy, not wanting to, you know, nothing's worth a human life, so he reaches back, and he hands the guy his wallet, thinking that's the end of it. Now, the robber, thinking he's got an easy mark, says, okay, now I want you to get down on your knees because I'm going to rape your wife, I'm going to kill her, and then I'm going to kill you. What he doesn't know is that the guy is a concealed carry permit holder. He reaches behind, pulls out a handgun, and drops three rounds center mass in the guy's chest. Okay, all of these killings, are they all intentional? People mean to do it, right? Okay, let's look at punishments. Scenario number one, the hitman. What happens to the hitman? If he's tried and convicted, what's going to probably happen to him? He's killed 45 people. Prison at the very least, death penalty in my state. Okay? Number two, the woman who comes home and finds her husband in bed with another woman and freaks out, grabs a shotgun and kills them both. We actually have a name for that kind of crime. We call it a crime of passion. She's not going to see the electric chair. As a matter of fact, she might not see 25 years. Right? Depends. Scenario number three, the guy was going to rape and kill his wife and kill him, said he was going to, had a blade in his hand. What's going to happen to that guy? Self-defense, nothing. All intentional killing, three completely different outcomes. So my response is I have no idea what we're going to do with women eventually. I can tell you one thing we will do. We will absolutely, once these laws are passed, if people are caught performing abortions, the abortionist definitely knows what they're doing. They're like the hitman in this scenario, right? The woman involved might be more like the crime of passion person. We've been living for 50 years with an ideology that says that what's in a woman's body is just a blob of tissue. Women get desperate. Women have had legal abortion for over 50 years. I don't know how we're going to handle that. But I'm going to argue that we probably should protect the unborn life first, and then we'll figure out the rest of it later. And we need to be in our schools teaching life-affirming truths about the unborn and teaching people how to engage in reasonable moral philosophy. So that is the moral case for life. I've got you till 8:30. I'm gonna be really nice to give you a 5-minute bathroom break. You have 5 minutes, bathroom break. Can you do it? Can you do it? Go ahead, you can get up. Run. You have 5 minutes. Go grab it. Okay? Yeah, I am going to send the pastor into the restroom later to haul you in back here. But yeah, get up. At least stand up and move around a little bit. These next 3 sessions go really, really fast. be flicking the lights off and on. If somebody could step out in the hall and call people in, that would be great. We've got to get done before 9 because I have to be able to get over to Texas Roadhouse and get that big ribeye that has my name on it. Because what I've had to eat today after a very, very early lunch has been a little bag of nuts and one of those little, I don't know what they call those, little wrapped up meat thing with a cheese thing in it. That's been my meal content today. I need to do better. Are they coming? When you went out there, did you do it with an authoritative voice? Yeah? Okay. All right. If you had to leave right now, you can't. But if you had to, for some weird reason, you would already be thoroughly equipped to discuss this issue with anybody at any public university or high school. Because we have made both the scientific and the moral case for life. And the bottom line is, it's just wrong to intentionally kill innocent human beings. So if I can prove to you that abortion intentionally kills innocent human beings, innocent human persons, if you want to go that way, if I can prove that, then abortion is wrong, right? It's really funny. I had this discussion with a guy at a genocide awareness project at Cal State San Marcos. The guy comes up to me, and we talked for a long time, and I'm giving him all the evidence that I gave you. And when we were finished, he said an interesting thing. He said, you know, I want to thank you for sharing your perspective. And he started to walk away, and I went, stop. And he came back, and I said, you need to understand something. I did not just share with you my perspective, like it's my personal opinion, like, oh, I like chocolate ice cream and you like vanilla ice cream, right? It's just my personal perspective. That's not what just happened here. I just cited for you evidence from embryologists, from renowned geneticists, from Planned Parenthood's own publications, from California Medicine. So now I'm a college professor, and I'm telling you, if you want to hold a different position, that means you have to have in your possession evidence that overcomes the evidence I have. You have to demonstrate that my evidence is somehow fatally flawed, right? It's biased in some way. But you might notice that almost all the evidence I provided doesn't even come from my side of the aisle. It comes from yours. So my challenge to you is to find out what made Planned Parenthood change its mind. It used to say that human life began at conception. They used to say that abortion kills the life of a baby after it has begun. What scientifically changed to cause them to alter their position? Was it 3D ultrasound? I guess not. That only further demonstrated the life of the unborn life in the womb, right? So they have obligations as well. So we're all done from a secular perspective. But I need to tell you, and I will demonstrate to you here in just a minute, the woeful ignorance about these issues inside the church. It's mind-bogglingly bad, folks. And I'm just going to cheap self-promotion. There's a book out in the lobby. It is called Contenders. I wrote this book. It's called Contenders, A Churchwide Strategy to Unmask Abortion, Defeat Its Advocates, Empower Christians, and Change the World. What you're getting here today is kind of a book review. So there's some of the stuff I have in the book is what I'm talking about today. There's a lot more in it. It is designed for messaging leaders in the church. This book can be picked up online for about $18.99. If you're an Amazon Prime member, you can buy it for $18.99 and get free shipping. Here, you can get it for $15 and get free shipping. Because I brought it here. It's physically out there. So if you have $15, you want to write a check, you can make it out to Speaker for Life. If you have cash, you can just leave it over there. I'm going to trust you. We're in the church. I hope that's wise. But at any rate, we desperately need to have the messaging leaders of our church know how to give a consistent, at the very least annual, catechism to to the people in our pews and to the young people in our Sunday school classes and youth groups. Because we have an opponent that is at least currently armed with $600 million of your taxpayer money in order to argue persuasively toward your young people. And by the way, it's not just about abortion. If you dare, you can go online to YouTube and go look at Amaze Jr. This is the series of animated cartoons that Planned Parenthood has put forward, and they are literally grooming videos. They are designed to help young people become more and more sexualized. There's one video, I'm telling you, it looks like it's made for a six-year-old. It's got a high school kid in it, and one of the things on his to-do list is have sex. There's another one where we talk about, is porn normal? Yes, it is, and it's free, and you can see it here. And these are the people who are telling you that they'll come into our office and we won't tell your parents. So they are literally trying to undermine you at every conceivable turn, and they have professional people working on their videos. We need to become aware of the fact we have an opponent, and we have to be preparing our young people and even our older people to know what is true so that they can defend themselves against the untruths that are being funded by our own money. So the problem really is that the church is doing a bad job communicating God's truth about abortion. So I'm going to go through it here really quick. The Ellen Guttmacher stack on abortion stats on the religious affiliation of women seeking abortions. I want you to listen to this. This is from German Jones and Onda in Characteristics of U.S. Abortion Patients in 2014 and Changes Since 2008. Now, some of you guys might be looking at this going, gosh, this seems really old. It takes a long time to gather up statistics, evaluate them, and get them published. This was published in 2016. Abortion patients were 24% Catholic, 17% mainline Protestant, and 13% were evangelical Protestant. That's 54% of all women seeking abortions self-identify as some kind of Christian. I'm telling you, if we could get people who self-identify as Christians to not have abortions, we would be shutting down Planned Parenthoods everywhere. They literally could not survive if they had only 46% of their current patient load. Lifeway Research in 2015 says that more than 4 in 10 women who have had an abortion were churchgoers when they ended the pregnancy. Only 7% discussed it with anybody at church. Just over half say no one at the church knows it. Nearly half of the women who have had an abortion, 49%, say the pastor's teaching on forgiveness don't seem to apply to terminated pregnancies. I did a longitudinal survey. It took place over many years. I surveyed over 1,000 college students in this deep research instrument, which, by the way, was about public speaking and whether or not professors should be able to censor the topics that students speak on. So one of the topics, obviously, that comes up often that professors don't want students speaking about is abortion. You ask them why. Well, you know, because it's overdone, because people have already made up their mind, because it's going to hurt people's feelings if they are post-abortive, right, all these reasons. So my thoughts were, you know, if this topic is really overdone and people have already made up their mind, I will bet you they know a lot about this topic. So they don't need to hear about it anymore because they know so much. So I surveyed them. I'm not going to toy with you by telling you how abysmal their responses were, even to simple things like how many abortions occur in the United States every year. In the first year that I did it, it was about 1.4 million. One of the students wrote 13,000, too many, and then wrote a little frowny face. Okay, off by orders of magnitude. But in the survey, I buried a question. The question was, if a woman came to you with an untimely pregnancy, to what local organization would you refer her? At the state universities where I conducted this survey, every single one of them had a pregnancy center nearby. 57% of the students answered Planned Parenthood. Now, they didn't fill in a bubble. They had to actually, it was an open-ended question. They had to come up with the name out of their head. Do you have any idea what 57% market share penetration looks like for a business? It's like Disney-level market penetration. 39% of the students wrote, I don't know. Add those numbers together, 96% of college students at state universities either don't know where they're going to send her or they're going to send her to Planned Parenthood where they will assuredly put that child to death. And by the way, for those of you who have heard, oh, but abortion's only 3% of Planned Parenthood services. These people do not know how to do math or do not have any idea how to handle statistics. I actually looked at Planned Parenthood's own service schedule, and what I will tell you is that in the case of, as a matter of fact, I actually have it here. I carry these things with me. In 2019, I had a report that was accessed on November the 7th, 2019. Abortions are up. These are just Planned Parenthood's abortions. Are up from 332,757 in 2019 to 354,871 in 2020. Prenatal care is down from 9,000, or so the number of abortions is 330,000. The prenatal care they offered went down from 9,055 to 8,626. And adoption referrals, by the way, they aren't actually handling anybody's adoption. They're just saying, oh, if you don't want to abort, I'll send you somewhere where you can engage in adoption services, went from 2,800 to 2,600. So abortions went up, prenatal care went down, adoption referrals went down. 90 of the women who came in for an abortion in the first year that I looked at this, they provided 366,000 166 services, 354,871 of which, or 97%, were abortions. So if a pregnant woman walks into Planned Parenthood, in 97% of the cases, that woman, the care that she's going to get is they're going to kill her child. Then I repeated this survey at a large Christian evangelical university that had 7 fully licensed pro-life pregnancy care centers around it. 7. Asked the question, if a woman came to you with an untimely pregnancy, to what local organization would you refer? By the way, keep in mind, as an organization, the church would have counted, right? You could have said my church. The number of students who wrote my church was so small it wasn't even statistically significant. That bears out what that woman said, right? Forgiveness doesn't apply to me. So these Christian students at an evangelical church are not going to refer her to their church. The number one answer at 42%, remember, 7 pro-life pregnancy centers all the way around them, fully licensed medical facilities. Number one answer at 53% was, I don't know. How could they not know? I can tell you how, because nobody at church is telling them. And nobody at their Christian school is telling them. But Planned Parenthood's got $600 million to tell them. So the number two answer at 42% was Planned Parenthood. Add those numbers together, that's 95% of college students, Christian, evangelical college students, 95% of them either don't know where to send that girl or they're going to send her to Planned Parenthood. Now, 6.5% did say the pregnancy center. Now, if you add those numbers together, you'll see that it comes to more than 100%. That's because on some of these questionnaires, you know what they said? Well, if she wants to keep the baby, I'll send them to the pregnancy center. But if she wants to get rid of the baby, I'll send them to Planned Parenthood. We asked a follow-up question. If you mentioned an organization, can you tell us where it's located? 80% of the students who named Planned Parenthood as their organization, 80% knew generally where it was located, but some so specifically that they gave us the cross streets and the building it was behind. Folks, we have a very severe communication problem on the life issue in the church. So what's the solution? The solution is inoculating the members of our church by teaching them the case for life. They need to know the scientific case, they need to know the moral case, so that they can interface with the secular students that they run into that don't share their biblical presuppositions. But they also need to know the biblical case for life in order to teach our people to value our children and to resist abortion advocacy. So what is the biblical case for life? I'll make it for you real quick. God's intentions toward humans are unbelievably simple. Human beings are image bearers of God. That's what Genesis 1:27 tells us. And God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female. He created them. God forms us in the womb, and he knows us. In Psalm 139, verses 13 through 16, it says, "For you formed my inward parts. You wove me in my mother's womb. I will give thanks to you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and my soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the depths of the earth. Your eyes have seen my unformed substance, and in your book were all written the days that were ordained for me, when as yet there was not one of them." Folks, people die at various ages. Some people, my wife, we had 2 miscarriages, so I have no idea why God chose to take the lives of 2 of my children before they ever got out. But he did. Some children die of sudden infant death syndrome in cribs. Some children die of cancer at the age of 9. I had a pastor friend of mine whose child died at a very young age. Some people died. A student body president of my high school died in a plane crash at 17. Some people die in their 20s, 30s. Some people die in their 80s or 90s. But God determines when people die. That's how it's supposed to be. Number 3, and probably the most popular command in the scripture, is in Genesis 1:22, where God commands Adam and Eve to be fruitful and multiply. By the way, that is a command that has never been rescinded, right? So God expects us to have kids, wants us to have kids. In fact, all through the scripture, it's God who opens and closes the womb. In fact, in the scriptures, we are told in Psalm 127:3 that children are both a gift from the Lord and a reward. Now, some people look at me and go, wait a minute, you're telling me that 15-year-old girl, it's a gift and a reward? So can I see the hands of all the omniscient people here today? No? Good answer. You don't know how that child is going to be a gift or a reward. But what if the child turns out to be a criminal? Well, then that child will have an impact on other people's lives, and God may find a way to use that. We don't know. All we're told is that we are not to intentionally put innocent human beings to death. God condemns the killing of the innocent in Exodus 20:13. I don't think I have to unpack that for you, right? God forbids murder. Okay. By the way, it doesn't forbid killing. Some people say, oh, God, do not kill. No, we kill stuff all the time. By the way, God commanded his people to kill people in the Old Testament. But you're not supposed to murder people, which means you're not supposed to go up to innocent people and intentionally take their life. The killing of children is an abomination associated in the Old Testament with idol worship. Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 35 is, they built the high places of Baal that are in the valley of Ben-Hinnom to cause their sons and daughters to pass through the fire to Molech, which I had not commanded them, nor had it entered my mind that they should do this abomination to cause Judah to sin. Back in the Old Testament, they're going through the desert, and then eventually in Jerusalem, they have the tabernacle at one time, they got the temple at the other time. They had a place where people could go and inquire of God, right? By the way, just like we do today, why we have churches. People could go and inquire of God. But sometimes you got to figure, they kind of knew what that God of Israel was going to say, and so they were kind of interested in a second opinion, right? Because the God of Israel is not the kind of God you bargain with, right? He's the kind of God you obey, right? So, you notice as you read throughout the Old Testament that they never managed to get rid of the high places. And one of the high places that they never seemed to manage to get rid of was the high place where they engaged in Molech worship. As a matter of fact, one of the wives of Solomon engaged in Molech worship. What happened in Molech worship? People wanted something. Molech was a fertility god, so if you needed rain for your crops or something like that, you could go to Molech. But when you go up to the priest of Molech, you got to bring your kid. So Molech is this huge idol. It's got the head of a bull. It's got the body of a man. It's got outstretched arms like this, and it's got a big hole in its belly, and inside the hole is a blazing fire. So the parents would come up. They would make a petition of Molech. By the way, there are places like Carthage. They have a thing called a tophet, which are just burial grounds where you can find bodies of children all over the place. And little rolled-up scrolls that say things like, I hope that this sacrifice is pleasing to the god Molech. They bring the child up. They are going to sacrifice this child. It's going to be a human sacrifice. As you can imagine, some parents might be a little connected to their kids, and if you shed tears, it would diminish the value of your sacrifice. So what did they do? They beat huge drums to drown out the screaming of the child. They would kill the child or place the child up in the arms. By the way, since there's a big fire and the idol's made out of bronze, the idol's very hot. Place the child on it, roll the child into the pit where the child's body would be incinerated. That's what Old Testament Molech worship looked like. Now I want to show you what modern day Molech worship looks like. What happens is women find themselves in distressing circumstances and they need to find a way out. Right, they have been told that they're going to lose their scholarship. Their boyfriend says, I'm going to leave you. Their parents said, I'm going to kick you out of the house. Maybe it's a husband who says, I'm going to kick you out of the house. I know this because my wife and I have been host home to two such women. One case was a husband. Other case was parents. Kicked her out of the house if she wouldn't abort. How's that for choice, right? So she came and lived with us. But so the circumstances are really, really rugged. I'm not going to get the promotion that I want because it's going to have to cut back on my travel. Now, they don't come to the church to inquire of the God of the Bible because they got a pretty good idea what the pastor's going to say. So they go and they get a second opinion. They go over to an abortion facility where they meet with a counselor, a lot like the priest of Molech, and they say, sure, we can solve your problem. All you have to do is give us some money and bring your kid. Now, she's got her kid with her because our culture has indoctrinated her to believe that it's a good idea to take your own child to a place to have it killed. And so she pays the money, she goes down the hall, and she gets on a table, which is kind of like an altar. And the doctor, comes in with the tools of his trade. He actually has instruments that are specifically designed to dismember unborn children or to poison them to death or to burn them to death. And then once they pull the child out, interesting little side note, by the way, remember when we talked about the idea that it was just a blob of tissue? Remember that? That's what they say? Once they take the baby out, they put it out on a light board, kind of like what you saw in the image up there. And suddenly, they see neural tissue, they see eye tissue, they see kidney tissue, and then they can actually sell those tissues to tissue procurement organizations. So what was a blob of tissue now becomes valuable human tissue. And then, but if they don't sell it, do you know what they do with it? They put it in a medical incinerator. Sound familiar? I'm not here to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that abortion is like Molech worship. I'm here to tell you that abortion is Molech worship. And the Apostle John said, little children, keep yourself from idols. Now, I want to make something abundantly clear here, folks. Abortion is a sin. Can I see the hands of all the non-sinners in the room? There is no sin you can commit that the blood of Jesus Christ is not sufficient to wash away. And if I'm telling you, statistically speaking, with this many people in this room, there are people in this room who have either had an abortion or who have participated in an abortion. And if that is you, at our center, we have post-abortion help, and we can help you get the counseling you need to find your way on the other side. I cannot tell you how many times at a class like this, at a banquet, at a pastor session even, I've had pastors walk up to me and tell me for the first time in their life, they've been carrying around for 20, 25 years. I've never told anybody, they say. And they reveal their abortion, and I guide them toward counseling because everybody needs the forgiveness of Jesus so that he can provide forgiveness and healing and restoration for you. So if that's you today, I want to encourage you to do that. Finally, abortion is not loving our neighbor. Right? God commands us to love our neighbor. Abortion is not that. What is loving your neighbor? Loving your neighbor is taking care of those that God puts in your sphere of influence. And there's nobody closer in your sphere of influence than a baby that is residing inside of your body. So let me talk about some common objections that people give. One that I hear all the time is that if this is true, then miscarriage makes God or nature the biggest mass murderer on the planet. And as somebody who's been through two miscarriages with my wife, I can understand why people might feel that way. People talk about miscarriage like it's no big deal. That's only the people who've never had one. If you've ever had one, you know it can be a big deal. Number two, God doesn't see the unborn as equally valuable to adults, and they actually cite a scripture, Exodus 21, verse 22 and 23. If men struggle with each other and strike a woman with child so that she gives birth prematurely, and yet there is no injury, he shall surely be fined as the woman's husband may demand of him, and he shall pay as the judges decide. But if there is any further injury, then you shall appoint as a penalty life for life. What they argue here is that God does not value unborn life because if two men struggle, they strike a woman, and she gives birth prematurely, that baby's going to die. And God doesn't require life for life, only if the woman gets injured. So let's take a look and see if these things are true. But my first response is the one to miscarriage, right? Life and death is God's jurisdiction, not ours. Everybody dies. By the way, it's really funny. I make my physician nuts. He goes, but no, we do this, it'll save your life. I said, no, it won't. It'll just postpone my death. Right? Billy Graham said it. He said the statistics on death are grim. One out of every one person dies. Right? But when we die is God's jurisdiction, not ours, and we are forbidden from taking the lives of the innocent. What about this value issue? First of all, the Hebrew word yelid and the Greek word brephos are intriguing words because they mean the same thing. They both are translated child, and they mean they're used for the child in the womb and child outside of the womb. So when we all said, right, a woman is with child, and everybody said child, that's what they're talking about. Just like we say that in English, that's what they would say in the scripture. When Jesus first meets the apostle John, where is he? He's in the womb, right? They meet, and John the Baptist, he has a reaction, right? So, and they're referred to as children. The death in the case that in the passage that they cite, the death is unintentional. It doesn't say if a man goes over and beats a pregnant woman so that she has a premature birth. It says if two men are struggling, and the indication would be that the woman is somehow struck along the way, not intentionally but unintentionally, and that as a result she gives birth to the child. Now I got to tell you, the verb there is that the fruit departs early. So some people argue, no, what they mean is she has a premature birth, and then if everything's okay, it's just a fine. No. In the Old Testament, they did not have neonatal intensive care units. So if children came out early, they probably had undeveloped lungs. But the key is the child doesn't die from the blow. The child dies because the child is undeveloped or not sufficiently developed. So God punishes even the accidental loss of life with the fine. And by the way, did you notice the fine is as the husband decides? Can you imagine in a life-affirming culture like this what the husband would decide? But imagine if it were intentional. Well, we know because God talks about what his attitude is toward the intentional killing of children. So now we understand the biblical case, and this is something we need to be teaching our young people routinely. I want to explain to you how abortion choice philosophy puts everybody at risk. There is a danger that is associated when people choose an arbitrary standard for who counts as one of us, because at any point in time, those goalposts keep moving, and you may find yourself on the wrong side of that indicator line. Don't think it can happen? Take a look at human history, folks. We've done this we've put people to death because they were the wrong color. We put people to death because they were the wrong ethnicity. We put people to death because they didn't have the right political ideology, right, to count as one of us. They were a danger to the state. So don't think it can't happen to you. We must have a clear, non-arbitrary, bright line distinction that indicates who is one of us and who is not, and that bright line distinction happens only in one place, at conception. I want you to listen to the analysis provided by Gary M. Atkinson in his essay, The Morality of Abortion. By the way, I highly recommend you read this. You'll notice at the top of your notes it says if you email Melissa, she'll send you a whole bunch of resources. So make sure you email her. You'll get a lot of this stuff. It is believed, listen to what he writes, it is believed, trying to determine who is and is not a protected human being, it is believed that the line can be drawn at birth, but the line is arbitrary and will be recognized as such by future generations precisely because it will be in their self-interest to do so and to justify infanticide and euthanasia. Those who desire infanticide and euthanasia have been given all the justification they need by the arguments supporting abortion. The only thing that remains to be done is to tear down the tissue of rationalizations that for the present acts as a barrier between abortion and euthanasia. Acceptance is first gained for abortion by emphasizing the irrelevant and even imaginary distinctions between a fetus and a newborn child. For example, one speaks of fetal tissue or developing human tissue or the products of pregnancy, while refusing to allow as linguistically proper any reference at all to the fetus as a child, which, by the way, as we noted earlier, that's what a fetus means, little one. Then, he says, having justified the killing of the fetus, right, by comparing it to the child and saying, see, it's really, really different, having justified the killing of the fetus, one proceeds to emphasize the similarities between the fetus and the infant so as to justify killing the born child and finally the adult. And we are seeing this happening over and over again, not only here in the United States, but in many Western countries. We are all at risk. This is an essay that appeared in the Journal of Medical Ethics. This isn't some weird outlying journal. This is a major medical journal. The essay is called Afterbirth Abortion, Why Should the Baby Live? By Alberto Giblini and Francisca Minerva. This is one of the most horrifying essays I've ever read in a peer-reviewed journal. They open up by basically saying that if a woman gave birth to a newborn child and her partner left her, she should be able to kill that child. But I just want to, I'm not going to toy with you, I'm just going to go right to the conclusion. I want you to listen to how they conclude this essay. First, we do not put forward any claim about the moment at which afterbirth abortion would no longer be permissible. Did you catch that? No limit. Now they do say, and we do not think that in fact more than a few days would be necessary for doctors to detect any abnormality in the child. This is if you were going to kill a child because the child came out and had some abnormalities. In cases where afterbirth abortion were requested for non-medical reasons, we do not suggest any threshold, as it depends on the neurological development of newborns, which is something neurologists and psychologists would be able to assess. So maybe now we're at 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 10 weeks, 24 weeks. Gets worse. Second, we do not claim that afterbirth abortions are good alternatives to abortion. Abortions at an early stage are the best option, both for psychological and physical reasons. And of course, my response is, why? Why for psychological reasons? Why? Because you didn't get a chance to see it. It didn't change what it was. But they continue, however, if a disease has not been detected during the pregnancy, if something went wrong during the delivery, or if economical, social, or psychological circumstances, remember all those ones we just went through, change such that, and I want you to listen to the word salad this guy puts together, if economical, social, or psychological circumstances change such that the taking care of the offspring becomes an unbearable burden on someone, then people should be given the chance of not being forced to do something they cannot afford. Okay, let me round that up for you. What they're saying is if you don't want to have that human being, you should be able to kill it. At what point? Who knows? Major medical journal, got a ton of pushback when it first came out. They backpedaled. We're philosophers, we're not public policy analysts. And then finally, a lot of people in the abortion camp started getting on board with them, and now they aren't quite so apologetic about this essay. Involuntary euthanasia is happening in Belgium in June of 2015 in the Journal of Medical Ethics, same journal. They examined the deliberate euthanasia of patients in Belgium without their explicit voluntary consent, which is required by law. The study's author, Raphael Cohen-Almaghor, a professor of philosophy and ethics at the United Kingdom's Hull University, found that life-ending drugs were used with the intention to shorten life and without explicit request in 1.7% of all deaths in Belgium in 2013. Not all deaths of people who were like terminally ill, all deaths. Now, in 52.7% of these cases, the patients were 80 years of age or older. The decision to euthanize was not discussed with the patient in 77.9% of the cases because he or she was comatose, had dementia, or because discussion would have been harmful to the patient's best interest, according to the study. So it's in your best interest for us to kill you, we think, but we don't want to burden you by telling you about it before we do it. Some people say, oh, I know, Mark, but you know, it could never really happen here. If you believe that, it demonstrates an incredible ignorance of world history. The German people, folks, were not a bunch of goose-stepping, mindless idiots. If you were old enough, maybe you watched Hogan's Heroes and you thought that's what the Nazis looked like. Folks, the Germans were some of the best educated people in all of Europe. They had the best continental universities. They were unbelievably literate. And yet, they managed to create a Reich where they would take an entire class of human beings, shove them in cattle cars, drive them outside of the gate of the city, and purposefully abuse and ultimately murdered over 6 million of those people. You know, some of those cattle cars went past churches, and the people were yelling and screaming as the cattle cars went by. And if some of you are familiar with the story, what happened in the church was they sang a little louder. Abortion shows it can happen here. Folks, I'm telling you right now, this is a very hard thing for people to hear, but compared to us, the Germans were pikers. They had to round people up, shove them into cattle cars, take them way outside of the city and put them to death. We have actually brainwashed an entire generation of people to believe that it's a moral and good and right thing to actually carry your child directly to a killing center, which does not have to be located outside the city limits. We'll drop it right in the middle of your suburb. And then you'll drive them in and pay for the privilege of having your children put to death. Folks, evil always comes in different guises. If you're waiting for Nazis to come goose-stepping down Main Street, you're going to wait a really long time. But evil always comes bearing the same principles, which is find the weakest and most defenseless image bearer of God and then dehumanize them, and then you are free to abuse and kill them all you like. California has their Future of Abortion Council, which was put together by Gavin Newsom, their governor. They have a list of 45 things they want to do. One of them is, let's say, okay, Roe versus Wade gets overturned. You guys become a pro-life state. California will take their taxpayer dollars and they will market abortion to your people. And then when they decide they want to go, these guys are arguing that California taxpayers will pay for them to fly to California. They will abort them in California free of charge. Intriguingly, if they have small children, they'll fly them too and provide child care for them while they kill their sibling. And then they will fly her back, all on the California's dime. So if you think that because we're going to be a pro-life state means you're out of the woods, you're not even remotely close to that truth. And in Robin Marty's book, she talks specifically about how they intend to invade pro-life states and flip them to make abortion legal in your state again. And if you're not aware of that or how that's going to happen, you better get that way, because it's coming. These people are devoted to taking the lives of unborn children. And so we've got to be there shining the light of the gospel, shining the light of truth. Not, we don't have to be quarrelsome. We don't have to be belligerent. Folks, I mean, the scripture says if you're going to suffer, suffer for righteousness. You don't have to be a jerk. Just tell people the truth and make a compelling and winsome case. I'm going to talk about one other thing you can do here in just a second. They also have AB 2223. Like I said, they're going to be legalizing or at least decriminalizing infanticide. So my recommendation is get Robin Marty's book and have a look. So what can you do? There are a few things that you can do. Authentic pro-lifers do two things. They speak up and they rescue. You can practically speak up by first starters continuing to study. Can I make a note here that being exposed to information is not the same as knowing it? Right? In here, all that's happened is we've been exposed to information. If you want to be able to use this information well, I can't tell you how many times I leave and people go, I just wish that you could come and talk to it. No, I can't. I'm only one guy. I traveled to 50 different states. I finally ticked off my 50th one last year. I spoke in Wyoming. Very small population. But I'm all over the place. You have to do it. It's like when you tell your pastor, can you please come over and evangelize my friend because they're the professional Christian. No, his job is to equip you to do it. So I'm here to equip you to do it through this a session like this. By the way, take these notes and reuse them in a class. Do it over 3 nights maybe, or do it over 3 class sessions maybe. But get a hold of my book. If you don't want to read my book, get a hold of Scott Klusendorf's book, The Case for Life. He's coming out with a new edition next year. Get a hold of Randy Alcorn's book, Pro-Life Answers to Pro-Choice Arguments. It's a really good reference book. It is a little dated now, but it's still pretty good. But once you get yourself ready to go, and by the way, it's not overwhelming, it's easy. In the 3 hours we've had here tonight, I have laid out everything for you. It'll take you a little longer than that, but not an egregious amount of time to grasp enough of this to be able to teach it. By the way, if you had to wait until you knew everything exhaustively before you taught anything, would anybody ever teach anything? No, teach what you know. Use your voices to be advocates. This means if you get letters to the editor, if you can be on a podcast, if you can write on social media and pass along important things, but make sure you always vet it thoroughly first, because you don't want to post stupid QAnon-y kind of things. You want to post legitimate stuff. Use your voice to advocate everywhere you can. And then if you're at a college or university, now would be a really good time to sponsor a debate. By the way, my first book was called The Great Abortion Debate Book. I still have 1 copy of it left and 3 CD versions. But I'm thinking very seriously about updating it and getting it back out again, because I think you're going to see these debates pop up all over the place, and we need to be ready to help people put them on. How do you practically rescue? First, pray. Folks, God can intervene where you cannot. God can speak to people's hearts when you're not even in the room. So pray. Number 2, volunteer. We have a pregnancy help organization right here, Starsha. What kind of volunteers do you need? So there's not a person in here that doesn't have an appropriate skill set to help these folks out. And these are tangible things. When women come in, they learn something really interesting. Do you know the other side says that we're fake medical clinics and we spew disinformation? Talk to any of our clients. You'll find out their standard of care is higher than in any other medical facility they go to. When you get involved with us, and everybody here's got some kind of a skill set that you can bring to bear on the center, when you get involved with us, you become a part of the legacy of life that can occur right here in Rock Hill. You can make a massive difference. So funny, we spend all this time on social media, and we learn about all this stuff that's happening worlds away that we can't do anything about. But you have a neighbor who's going through an untimely pregnancy right now. It doesn't matter about Roe versus Wade. It just matters about her. What is she going to do? We've got the answers for her, and you can help them to get those answers. The other thing you can do is give to your PRC, and we're going to do a time of giving. We're going to pass things around. Do you have a pledge forms or anything like that here, Starsha? Did you bring any? Didn't bring any? Okay. Well, if we've got a plate or if we got anything, or Starsha, you can stand up here. We'll take checks. If you're coming to the banquet, you can come there and give a check. But if you're not coming to the banquet, please become financially involved in the life of the center. Do you want to know what a difference it would make if you gave the center $5 a week? That's literally $20 a month. That's more than a lot. Less than a lot of you guys spend on coffee. If you give $20 a week at a lot of banquets in this country, you would be giving annually more than a middle-class business person gives at an average banquet. Let me clarify, not at the banquets I speak at, but you know, those other banquets. But I want to encourage you, I think all of us can do that. My son, when he was a little boy, he used to take these precious feet pins out and he would sell them. He'd steal them out of my jacket and then go sell them. At the end of the month, he would gather up the money and give it to our local PRC, Birth Choice. Everybody can do it. There's no restriction. So we're going to do some donation before we leave. Or Starsha, you can come up here. And folks, we're going to pray, and then you can write some checks if you want. And then finally, we've got an applied bioethics training at Cedarville University this summer. If you're a college student and you've not yet had a speech class and you want to get a really good speech class for very little money, you can come up. Somebody here's from Lee. Who's from Lee here? You're from Lee. You had your speech class at Lee? Sorry, how many speeches did you give? How many's too many? Okay, in my class, you would give 20 in the span of 1 week. Yeah, okay, so I'm rugged. And by the way, you'd only get 30 minutes to prepare for any of them. But by the time I'm done with you, you'd be a monster. But you can come and you can take a class at Cedarville University and you will learn pro-life apologetics from Scott Klusendorf, and then I get you for a week and I will turn you into an outstanding pro-life public speaker. If you have teenagers, you want to go and Google Summit Ministries. Help them to become grounded in a biblical worldview. It's a great place to go. My friend Scott teaches there. And then you can always consider becoming a missionary for the unborn through LTI. or you can start learning how to work in the pregnancy center movement. Begin an Embrace Grace program at your church. I don't know how many churches I have represented here, but if you don't have an Embrace Grace program, I want you to found one. Find out about it. We'll be happy to tell you about it. Embrace Grace is the bridge between the church and our center. So when you have clients that come through our center and come to know Jesus, we can bridge them into your church. And folks, there's nothing wrong with considering a career in PRC work. Folks, that's the case for life. This is the thing we need to contend for. And it's easy to come to something like this. You look around and you see how many people live in this area. You see how many people are in this room. Most people cannot make this case for life, not even remotely. But you guys have gotten the beginnings of being able to do that. And so I'm going to have to challenge you. God holds you responsible for everything you ever learned. So too late. You need to go out and repeat this stuff so that people can hear it. And remember, if somebody asks you a question and you can't answer it, you will say, that's right. And if you do manage to come across that professional philosopher, it's okay. Grab my business card or contact me through Speaker for Life, because I'm going to promise you, I know, and I will tell you, and then you can pass it along. I want to do two quick things. I want to pray, and then I'm going to answer any questions that you guys have until you're sick of me. Some of you guys are going, that happened about 30 minutes ago. But I will stay here and answer. You can play Stump the Pro-Lifer with me. Ask me any kind of questions you want. Darsha can be in the back, and she'll be happy to talk with you. And if you've got a check for her, and I hope you do, hand it to her. If you don't, I'm sure there's a way to give online. Okay? And so you can give online. Go to the site tonight. Don't wait till tomorrow. You won't do it. Do it tonight. So I'll answer questions. We'll do that. But before we do any of that, let's pray real quick. Father in heaven, I'd like to thank you for an opportunity to be together with these folks. Father, what we've talked about today is very dark and very difficult and very painful. But Father, we live in the midst of a dark and dying world, but you have given us the light of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we are supposed to produce good works that shine in such a way as that it gives glory to you. So Father, I pray that you will send us out into the world to advocate on behalf of the least of these, our unborn brothers and sisters, our neighbors. They've got a target on their back by a very powerful, well-funded lobby, and the only thing standing between them and death is frequently the voice of your followers who are working to help young women and young men make life-affirming decisions. So we thank you, Father, for the pro-life work that's being done here, for the pro-life work that's being done throughout the country. We ask, Father, for your blessing and your protection on the Supreme Court justices until this decision comes down. And pray, Father, that you help us all to judge with sober judgment the ramifications of this decision so that we will know that we are not at the end of the game, but only in the middle, and that we need to continue fighting until we can protect the lives of all human beings from the moment of conception till natural death. We thank you, Father, for the wisdom that you give us through your word, through our ability to learn, through the minds that you've given us to put arguments together, and for the mouths that you give us to speak. Pray that we will utilize all of those features to the best of our ability so that we can give a good account of ourselves someday when we stand before you. We ask for all of these things in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Starsha's going to be in the back. Oh, she's got a plate. Watch out, she's got a plate. You can use that plate. Questions? Fire away. Yes, sir.